Okay. All right. So we're going to start off the pitches. There's a couple of missing panel members. They snooze, they lose. That's what I was told. So up next, we have Time Savvy. Please welcome them with a warm welcome of applause.
Hello, everybody. My name is Hossein, the CEO and co-founder of Time Savvy. Our startup, Time Savvy, provides an intelligent delivery arrival time notification system. Before everything, I would invite you to see a video, and then we'll go ahead. So just Well, as this might have already happened to many of you, this is a public pain that forces people to stay at home for a long time in order to receive their deliveries. And if it's eventually failed, they have to pick it up personally at post offices. And at the business level, I just touched upon the example of Pirulator, where they're getting over $13 million wasted per year because of the second deliveries that they have to operate. And also, it drastically decreases their customer satisfaction. So currently, couriers provide the customers with tracking information through which they can see in what cities their products are or if it's already departed from the depot. But what happens exactly after the departure from the depot is missing. So that's why we created our startup Time Savvy, receiving data and information from couriers, processing it, and coming up with regularly updated and intelligent estimations of delivery arrival times that would be transferred to final customers through different platforms such as smartphone. And our product forces a lot of real-time variables such as construction going on, traffic, weather condition, the driver and package characteristics, as well as the number of deliveries to be operated per address or stop. And the notifications are real-time, as I mentioned. We use state-of-the-art data method science. And also, we learn a lot from the public users, which all the other competitors are totally missing. Just let's see the demo of the product. First, you receive the notification of your delivery, and then upon clicking on it, you're going to have the delivery arrival time estimation, as well as your turn in the queue to be delivered by the same vehicle. And if ever you forget about your delivery, you're still, for example, here 30 minutes away from your address, and in 30 minutes, you're going to be delivered. We're going to make sure that we send you a notification that it's the right time for you to leave towards your mailing address in order to receive your delivery. Pirulator currently is getting over 10% of its business to customers' deliveries failed, which means something between 4,000 to 6,000 delivery failures per day, or $13 million per year only in the Canadian market. But you're looking at the global market where tons of different couriers, small, medium-sized deliveries are operating. So our customers are first couriers, followed by retailers and small deliveries, medium-sized one as well. Manufacturers and suppliers that are carrying sensitive materials, it's important for them to know at what time it will arrive. Public transportation as well as public users. And a recent survey that we conducted over 100 Canadians, they said that they would prefer a shipping service that is working with Time Savvy 40% more than a shipping service that does not. And the desirability of our product was ranked 3.5 out of 5. And they said that they would increase their online shoppings by 28% if they are delivered with a shipping service that is working with Time Savvy. So we'll be providing white label service for big couriers and big companies, as well as branded service for small providers and deliveries, and freemium memberships for public users. Our pricing strategy is going to depend on the volume of deliveries operating per delivery system. Together with the amount of improvement that we're going to make in the delivery system, as well as customer satisfaction for our own customers. To go to market, we counted on the network of our coaches and partners. Recently, for example, one of our coaches connected us to Pirulator. Upon the successful beta test on Pirulator, we're going to reach out to the rest of the market, small and medium-sized deliveries, etc. Currently, UPS My Choice and FedEx are providing one-time estimations of delivery arrival time, which could be deviated up to hours from the actual delivery arrival time. And there is another category of appointment scheduling systems that they are providing different time windows for the customers. And another company that is working in this area is Bring, that they are only a communication platform that they are connecting customers and delivery systems. And they raised $2.5 million in December 2013, followed by $5 million in December 2015. And the thing is that they do not provide any estimations of delivery arrival time. So we'll be making $100,000, $500,000, and $3 million in the first 3 years. Recently, we participated in a three-month business model evaluation program in the University of Montreal, as well as we have created our first prototype, the transportation algorithm, together with website and mobile application in Android. And we made a pitch at Ange Quebec. Puro later sent us a non-disclosure agreement to sign in order to beta test on their system. And we will finish our MVP and the beta testing with Puro later in October 2017, followed by adding new platforms to notify customers in January 2017, for which we need to raise $300,000. We were ranked first among 20 teams at Défi Entrepreneuriat Diversité at the University of Montreal, and we were accepted into a 12-week startup program at the HEC Montréal, and we are being supervised by Kobe and Robert from Yes Montreal. Kobe has been an executive at Puro later for 25 years, and by Jo Van Betsbroek from National Research Council Canada, as well as Madame Rakoto from the University of Montreal. We are three PhD candidates in computer science. I'm working on a routing problem with a background in system engineering. Rahim is working on network design with a background in transportation, and Vahid is working in routing problem with a background in production engineering. We are also negotiating in order to add one business developer together with a machine learning and artificial intelligence expert. So thank you for your attention, and I'd be more than happy to listen to your questions.
Hi. Good, do you hear me? Yeah, okay. Good, great presentation.
Thank you.
I think clearly people want to know when they're going to get their package delivered, the exact time, and be there. So I think you found something of value, that's for sure, and it's going to be addressed. So you're working with Puro later. What's the status of that, basically?
Yes, actually, we have made a successful pitch in Puro later 2 months ago, and they were very happy about the product, and we decided to start beta testing on them. They sent us a non-disclosure agreement. We sent them ours, and our lawyers are talking and negotiating in order to sign it and start beta testing.
If you work with them, you're not gonna work with any other carrier. I guess you'll be there connected.
No, it's just beta testing.
Just beta testing.
Yes, for the beginning.
Okay.
Doors are open. It could be developed to other market segments.
It seems like it's something that's going to be like a department inside FedEx or inside the UPS or inside Puro later, one for each. They have their own way of doing it, and you're trying to be that department almost.
Well,
but
as I mentioned, there are many market segments that it could be applied to. Puro later, the good point with Puro later and large companies, we know that they have bureaucratic processes.
Yeah.
They have their own complexities. But the good thing is that it will provide us with a very, very large number of public users. And
yeah,
geographically, we can get our product tested everywhere across Canada.
Can I follow up on that question?
Yeah.
And maybe go a little bit deeper? Do you see yourself as a product
Yes.
business or a service business?
Sorry, I didn't understand your question.
Do you see yourself as a product
Yes.
driven business or a service-driven business?
It's a service-driven business, but there is still things to see in beta testing, how it's gonna be. But what we want to do, what we want to be separate from this, from the businesses, from couriers to other market segments, and we have our own independent identity, and to work with them. That is what we desire about.
But your goal is to service each of these clients?
Yes.
With specific products that answer their needs and not to have a standalone product that can be mass market?
Yes, actually, as I mentioned, we want to, after beta testing it, we will reach out to other market segments as well. We know that big, that giant companies, they want their own product. We fully understand that. But the thing is that market is so big. There are many, many market segments that have not been touched yet by a very good service. What that is what we want to march to actually work into.
Does that answer your question? I guess you want to know, are they going to sell? You're going to sell this to all the shipping companies that ship products to personal houses so that they're able to offer this to their customers. Is going to be invisible white label, and it's going to be Pure Later branded, or is it going to be your little brand as well?
Both is possible. As we showed in the presentation, it could be white label service for the giants such as Pure Later, but it could be a branded service for a smaller one.
And how much are you going to sell it for? How's it going to work for when you work with the big clients? Like, what's your idea? Your idea of how you're going to sell it to the big clients? You're going to charge them?
I'm going
to skip that part. Sorry.
Yes, that's what we think. It could be SaaS.
Yeah.
And what the thing is that we are still open to that because the product has not been beta tested completely yet. We have the product. We have the prototype. We should beta test it to see how it's going to work. But we know that for smaller couriers, for smaller deliveries, we are going to have much more flexibility.
Thanks.
Yes?
Sorry, I might have missed it, but I was just, I guess, following along on that question. I wasn't quite clear on the revenue model that you're looking to put in place. Is it going to be borne by the customer as an added service, or is it an OEM level?
By customer, do you mean users?
Yes, like I would pay more to know that I'm not going to have to go somewhere to pick up.
No, it's going to be for free for public. We are not going to charge the public.
Okay.
So
the people who are using our platform, the public user, people who are using our app in their smartphone, we are not going to charge them. We only charge the courier and the business users, the courier and shipping services, the giant and the small.
So I still look at the figure of $30 million in saving or $30 million impact in terms of missed deliveries. So what is your pricing model to them?
Yeah, as I mentioned, our pricing model depends on the volume of the deliveries that they're making, together with the amount of improvement that we'll be able to make for them, that we are going to see that in the beta testing phase. And also, the customer satisfaction, because as I talked about in the graphs that you saw, on 100 Canadians, they said that they would increase their online shoppings by 28%. Literally, they will buy $86 more every year if they are delivered with a courier that is working with a service such as TimeSavvy.
And I have to add that. UPS has invested too much up to now to create the My Choice service just for the sake of customer satisfaction. Because they are already very organized delivery courier service, but they have invested in the My Choice service too much.
So just for the sake of customer
satisfaction. So we just have one more question, actually.
Yes.
Yeah, so how do you reconcile with the fact that a lot of the people you want to work with already have a way for people to track the services that they get from, the goods that they get from their services? Because ultimately, I think you guys have a lot of value in providing software as a service directly to them, and then people can track through their platform. But for consumers to then go onto another platform to be able to track, like, any good that uses, I mean, Yoaster, it doesn't really make sense to me. I think you're better off working directly with OEMs and just bettering their current technology. I think that's what makes sense.
I missed the last part of your quiz.
It was more true. Like, how do you reconcile with the fact that all these couriers already have their own consumer facing interfaces for tracking delivery?
Yeah, for us, the most important thing is to create the service and to deliver it to them. We understand that big giant companies want to have their own interface. We fully understand it. The most important thing for us is to be able to do the notification system, as well as if we can have access to their public customers. Because, as I mentioned, part of the job that we are doing is to learn from public people, which all the other companies are missing, to make sure what is their transportation mode, how long it's going to take them to get home, or if they are 30 minutes away from apartment, from their place, to let them know. These are many things that we want to learn from public users. We won't care much about the giants if they want to have their own interface. The more important thing is to create the service and to have access to those public users, to the data.
All right. Thank you, guys. Great pitch.
Thank you. And if I have just 10 more seconds, we were also contacted by a European courier for our service, who are operating already 2 million deliveries per day, and we hopefully will make a pitch in next weeks for them. Thank you.
So next up, we're going to have Jean-Louis Maréchaux from IBM Canada. He'll be talking about digital innovation for tech startups. Jean-Louis has been with IBM for over 10 years, and he's been in with IBM in different roles, and he's the cloud advisor at IBM. As a certified master cloud advisor, he consults with businesses on roadmaps and pragmatic technology adoption. Please give a round welcome, warm round welcome of applause to Jean-Louis. Thank you.
Thanks. So I'm cold, I'm wet. I don't know about you. I work for IBM, so I'm not part of a startup anymore. IBM is no longer a startup. Well, the goal today, I'm going to talk about digital innovation and the kind of course, IBM tools that you can use if you want to, but you don't have to. I'm not a seller. I'm a cloud advisor. Closer?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm not alone today. I'm with Randy over there. So, unfortunately, after this talk, I'm going to have to leave for a meeting with a client. But Randy will be there outside under the rain somewhere to answer any question, if you have any question. You can also reach out to me anytime. There's probably my contact information somewhere, whatever. You want to create startups, you have an idea, you want to create apps. So the question is, are you going to create apps for the last century, or will you try to reinvent the future? What I heard today is that a lot of companies or startups or individuals that I've seen today, they have a brilliant idea and an idea that is really for the future. And we believe that with such an idea, you need also bleeding edge technologies to be able to deliver a real product and have a real impact to real customers. Second aspect of it, if you create a startup, are you going to work alone? Are you going to be the lone duck in this picture? Or are you going to work in a broader ecosystem? And this is the kind of activity like this is really the way to interact with more and more people and reach out to people like you, people who are going to help you or assist you with technology, with financial aspects, with anything. At IBM, we want to help you with technology. We have no money, so we cannot do anything. Well, that's not true. I'm going to talk about that later. We've got some money. So then you're going to build something. Are you going to build everything from scratch? Are you going to develop an application from scratch, or are you going to be able to leverage existing services? If you build something from scratch, you will succeed. You will create something, no doubt about that. Will it be cutting edge? Will it be user-friendly? Not sure. If you try to focus on your business, because you're not maybe all technical hackers, so if you want to leverage existing services, you're going to be able to focus on what really matters, so what you want to provide to end users and customers. Well, that's why we believe that to really innovate in a business, you need to focus on your business aspects and reuse the rest of it. Reuse existing services, rent existing hardware, compute, storage, and services. You don't have to buy them. You don't have to build them from scratch. Other people already did it for you. And is there a laser on that? Okay. Well, anyway. Yeah, I got it, but I can point here, but oh yeah, it works. Sorry, I was looking for a green one because I've got a green gizmo like that. Well, it does not work very often. Yeah. So those are the services I'm talking about, the compute services that you can leverage in your environment. And you can reuse services from IBM. We've got a few of them. You can reuse services from a broader ecosystem. You don't have to use one unique provider. You can build an ecosystem or leverage the ecosystem to be able to build your applications. At IBM, we've got a cloud offering that is called Bluemix. Bluemix is a platform as a service for the technical people in the room, which means that you can not only provision environments, so compute environment, virtual machines, and servers. So those are the real compute nodes and storage. But you can also have, on top of that, a lot of different pre-built, pre-configured services. So instead of building services from scratch, you can assemble services to deliver a brand new application so that you focus on your business. You do not focus on the plumbing. You do not focus on configuring servers, configuring databases, configuring access to emails, and a lot of different other services that you need if you want to create a mobile app and deliver a mobile app to end users. The Bluemix platform is built on open source and open standards, stuff like OpenStack, Cloud Foundry, and a couple of other open source providers. Part of the Bluemix platform, there's IBM services that you can leverage. Some of them are free. There's a freemium for each one of them. And at some point, if you want to use services, you have to pay IBM for some of them if you go ahead of the predefined freemium. But part of the platform, there's also third-party services, so it's not only IBM stuff in there. We've got partnership with a lot of people. And community services, open source services that you can use most of the time for free. You can also build your own services and have them added to the platform. The platform is not IBM only. It contains your services, third-party services like Twilio, if you ever heard about Twilio, that's the first one that I have in mind, which is an SMS provider or SMS as a service. And we've got a lot of others, and I will not go in that direction because we've got too many, actually. When you use Bluemix, you can use services in different categories. So mobile services, Internet of Things, to be able to connect devices, real devices, concrete devices to the cloud. Data and analytics, you can use cognitive analytics stuff. So we've got a super computer called Watson. So if you want to reuse Watson services, cognitive services, to do speech to text or vice versa, to be able to, what else? There are 16 Watson services. Randy, help me. Visual recognition, translation in 5 or 10 different languages. Yeah, it's, well, Yesterday it was something, today it's something else, and tomorrow it's going to be different. So there's 16 different services in Watson for cognitive. There are services to be able to develop and deploy application quickly. Security services, web, of course, storage, and one very important, the API services, being able to create your own APIs and connect to the ecosystem. So being able also to create your application that integrates with, say, I don't know, Twitter and Facebook and Purolator services, because someone talked about that before. So every different services, everything that is available through APIs. I don't expect that you can read that. It's just to give you a sense of the different services that we have in Bluemix. And the whole idea, the most important, is really the subtitle. Instead of focusing on the technology and the plumbing in innovative applications, we believe that you should leverage existing services and compose application easily with existing services. So once again, the different categories that you can leverage out of Bluemix. I just took 6 different services out of the, we've got 120 something yesterday. Today I don't know, but a lot. So 6 of them. One that I already mentioned, the cognitive computing with Watson. So through APIs, and I was talking to somebody before, from your own application, you don't even have to be on Bluemix. From your application through HTTP calls, so REST APIs, you can access Watson services and you can leverage those services in your applications. Another interesting one, and it got more and more traction in the clients I'm working with, the weather company. We acquired the weather company last year, I believe. They have a lot of data on weather and forecast on rain. So maybe the organization should leverage the weather company for the next event, to be able to forecast whether or not it makes sense to be in a tent. Sorry about that. A lot of companies I'm working with, they plan to include weather data in their systems. It could be, so I'm not allowed to give any name, it could be, I don't know, insurance company, banking industries, travel and vacation, but this one is easy, air traffic, stuff like that. So they want to include weather data because it makes a lot of sense to their business. Even aware of a company that are selling wine, and they want to consider the weather in their process as well. Because you and I, we don't drink the same thing if it's raining or if it's hot or cold outside. I'm probably late, am I, already? Nobody tells me anything. So I'm gonna stay there the whole afternoon, okay? We have a partnership with Apple, and for the technical people in the room, there's a new platform, the Swift development language from Apple. We are also providing Swift on Bluemix so that people can develop mobile application using Swift, but also back-end application using Swift. IoT services is really how you can connect devices. So we've got a lot of different services to be able to connect, manage, and process data out of devices. So sensors and stuff like that. I was at another event yesterday evening for to save the St. Lawrence River. And I met a lot of people who are considering using sensors on the river to be able to get real-time data and react, do something, process data and do something with it. We've got a new technology also called OpenWhisk that we open source recently, which is an event-driven model. And not sure how many people heard about blockchain so far? How many people heard about Bitcoin? Much more. So blockchain is the technology. Yeah, okay. So you go online and you learn about blockchain because I only have 3 minutes. But interesting technology, and we have a service on Bluemix for blockchain, and it does not click. We have a program, and Randy will be able to share more information on that. But if you are a startup and you want to apply, you can be eligible for free credits on Bluemix and on our other, well, free IBM credits. Depending on your business model and a couple of additional questions, you're going to be eligible for a 2K per month or 10K per month. There's a link over there. You just have to apply. And this is for, it's USD, but actually the link, you're going to apply as a startup in Canada. So you need to be in Canada. The person in charge of that is in Toronto. When you apply, you're going to have support for go-to-market, mentoring, and help on technical expertise. How many minutes? One? 1 minute, one slide. I should be okay. So we are also doing meetups in Montreal. So if you are interested, we're doing that at the Nutman House, downtown Montreal. The next one is end of May, and you can contact me. I'm leading the meetup in Montreal. I just wanted you to have the link. Are these slides going to be shared with all the participants? Okay, cool. So you're going to have all the information you need to go to the meetup or contact me or do something else. That's about it for me, right on time. Amazing, huh?
Thank you, Jean-Louis.
So, and one thing to say, Jean-Louis, we are one of the ones that actually started using the service last year. As I mentioned earlier today, we actually had another hosting service before that didn't quite have the uptime. We had lots of service issues with, and we were wasting a lot of time refactoring code to kind of get it to work the way we wanted to. It's been a dream with IBM, so... Thank you, that's been great. I think what we need to probably start working on next is our API to the Weather Channel. Hard part is, you know, I think we need to get that so it's really, really accurate for us. All right, so next up we have a company that is going to another pitch company. So I'd like to welcome Alistair and Raman from Motorleaf.
Hi. First time I've had a microphone in front of me, so bear with me. All right, so we're going to talk to you about the food industry, agriculture, and where we think we're going to fit in. So as you probably are aware, there's a world food shortage, and that means that the prices are going up. So why is that? Let's go back in time just a little bit. So when people used to travel abroad and find new countries to conquer and live in, they used to arrive, and the first thing they had to do was grow food because they had to feed all of their troops and the people that they were bringing over. So they used to find the best arable land so it was easier for them to grow crops. And those settlements grew into villages that grew into towns that grew into cities. So where is the arable land now? Well, we had to go further afield because we're literally living on the best land that was available. And that land that we're growing on is having problems because of the environment, the fact there's less water, et cetera, et cetera. So you would think that something like this is going to solve all of those problems, and we should be doing that right now. Why are we not growing indoors everywhere? There's a few key reasons. Let's look at Lufa Farms, pretty popular place in Montreal to grow leafy greens. The capital cost is really high. That costs $2 million just to put the greenhouse up. And there's only 10% of roofs in a city that would actually take the weight. So they can't do it everywhere. Next, if you're lucky enough to find a space that's going to work for you, the labor cost of growing indoors is about 70% of your production cost. So it's very, very expensive to do. And if you do get the labor and you can afford it, the people who are growing indoors, they have to manage loads of different parts of the indoor grow environment. So you want to keep a level environment so your crops are going to grow in a uniform manner. So they have to do loads of different things, such as look after the lights, make sure there's the right temperature, the humidity, everything's being timed perfectly. So there's lots of spinning plates. And if one of those crashes, your entire crop is screwed. So introducing Motorleaf. With Motorleaf, we connect with all of the existing equipment that's being used to grow indoors. And the equipment that's already being used to grow indoors controls things like the feeder pumps, the lights, the humidifiers, etc. And when those two things are connected, something magical really happens. And it really is like Fantasia with Mickey Mouse. He does his magic spell. Everything comes alive and starts working together. So what does this mean? It means that our four pieces of hardware are connected to the grow equipment. And when that happens, the automation starts taking place, and the plants can actually be programmed to grow automatically. While that's happening, we have artificial intelligence, automation, grow recipes, alerts, and timers, all in one place for the farmer to be able to control from anywhere in the world. So what we do very simply is connect the existing, i.e. agnostic, grow equipment to our hardware, and the growers choose what they want to control and how much space within their grow environment they want to control. So a lot of people at this point, they say, how do you connect? So we're going to do a live technical demonstration. Raman, my CTO and co-founder, could you please come? Welcome, Raman. So I will be Motorleaf, and you will be the grow equipment.
Heater. You'll be a heater.
A heater.
Okay. That is how easy it is. This is from our hardware. They just plug it in. That's it. Thank you. Thank you very much. I've lost my little thingy now. Hang on. Thank you. Could you do the next slide? Oh. Okay, so we then designed all this. It's working. We're pretty happy with it. So we had to go out and find some people to give us some money to make sure that it wasn't just us that liked it. So here's a few different people who have actually paid us and pre-ordered our hardware and software. So we have Price Chopper Store with a hydroponic setup in their fruit and veg. Vermont Hydroponic grow tomatoes and lettuce. We've got a company who have grow cabinets so you can grow at home, who want Motorleaf inside. We've got high schools and we've got medical marijuana being grown in BC with lots of pounds of herbs being grown. So let's use Price Chopper as an example. So what was their problem? Well, their problem was they had to pay a guy to drive an hour each way to look after that $80,000 display. And he had to manually look after it in many different ways. He had to water it, he had to check the nutrients, he had to everything manually. You plug in Motorleaf and everything works perfectly. It's now automated. He can access all his data 24/7 and he can even see it through a webcam that's connected. So what does this mean? It means that we can now automate, we can machine learn, we can collect data from all of the different people who are growing whatever crop they're growing, and we can feed them back the best grow recipes based upon live data that we are looking at. So you can basically press a button and grow any crop. So what does that mean? It means that if I was sat in front of that laptop, I could be in charge of maybe 10 or 20 different locations. So that's sounding a bit futuristic. Maybe the future is a bit more like that. Maybe there's going to be cows on skyscrapers. But we don't think so. We think the future looks more like this, where every available space can be and should be used for growing to feeding our populations closer to where they live. So back to today. Everything on the green circle on the left-hand side is what we're doing right now. We have four pieces of hardware that speak to what we call the heart, which is the piece of hardware at the top of the screen with machine learning, automation, grow recipes, alerts, etc. And our next step is to make our system accept and recognize other people's hardware. So you don't have to buy our hardware. We want to be hardware agnostic, which is coming pretty soon. And then just like Apple, we want to have an app store so that third parties can access our data and provide more services. And because of that, we think there's a fairly good chance that some big organizations are going to want to purchase us in the future. And here's the main reason why. The data that we collect is really unique and really valuable. So I'm not going to read all of them, but take a look and just imagine how much that information is going to be worth when it's taken from countries all over the world. Thanks very much. So the if you compare it to big agriculture, it's about a tenth or less right now.
And do I understand correctly? This play is essentially just for indoor hydroponics.
It could be used both indoor and outdoor. We concentrated our market more indoor now, just because it's the easiest market to go for. But now it's just a matter of creating the right hardware so that we can move it outdoors.
Hi. Good presentation for sure. I think anybody growing crops indoors wants to use technology to do a better job. But how do you guys compete against the other competitors who have no idea of the other products in your industry? How do you...
It's a little bit like asking before or when, let's just say, Nest first came out, like, well, other people can control the temperature of a house, like, you know, what's so special about Nest? It's the same idea, really, but for agriculture. So there are other companies that make timers, for example, where you could hook up your heater or your air conditioning. You might have 10, 15 different systems controlling different things, but you want to find one that unifies everything? No, there isn't.
Well, and also to be accessible over the internet that you could control via anywhere in the world.
Do you already have some customers?
Yeah. So we are sort of pre-selling, I suppose you could say. I mean, the ones that we showed on the screen, like Price Chopper and the schools and the Vermont Hydroponic, yeah. And we've just finished getting the hardware ready so that we can sell it. So we're sort of, if you like, we're pre-revenue, but we have collected pre-orders which are fully paid.
Where do you manufacture your hardware?
Well, we're doing only very small quantities right now, so everything's being done in Quebec. And right now we're in negotiations to have it done overseas when we go from 10 to 100 to 1,000. So when we start talking hundreds to thousands, then we're going to do it overseas.
And the cost that you sell it for?
So there are four different pieces of hardware, and they vary in price from, like, a smart plug, for example, is about $125 US. And one of the more complex pieces that has really expensive probes inside of it is more like $600-$700 US. So the cost per customer depends on how large a space they want to control and also how many different crops they want to control at the same time. So an average sale, if you want, for a commercial space could be anywhere from 5,000 to maybe 20,000, something like that. But if you wanted to grow something in your home, for example, you could probably spend $500 or $600 and we could help you.
Well, just to expand on that, I created the hardware in a way where it's fully expandable through a wireless mesh network. So we're able to add up to 250 different nodes into our system so that we could basically move into any kind of sensoring industry you want to.
Hi, how much money are you looking to raise in this upcoming round, and what will it be used for?
Yeah, it's a good question. $1.5 million seed round. So this is the Motorleaf team, pretty much. So everything that needs to be done is going to be based around improving the hardware scalability, obviously bringing on board more talent. the usual, I suppose. Also some patent applications. We feel that there's a few things that are pretty unique about what we're doing that we're going to be looking at. We work with Faskin legal firm, and they have some IP people that are pretty interested in moving on that, but we want to wait until we have a bit more cash.
Hello, hello. I had the same question, but I have another question. How far are you in the development of your hardware?
We're moving up to our first 10 units, and so that we could start selling more and then moving into a more sustainable production production process.
But they work. Right?
Okay, they work. So there's no R&D anymore? There's no technological risks?
There's no technological risks. We're ready to be selling.
Well, there's also the being able to accept the other...
Oh, well, yeah, we're trying... With our seed round is what we want to get our agnostic hardware.
So.
All right, so that was very interesting. It's always kind of fun to see like cows on top of buildings. So makes you think about different things. All right, so the next one we're going to have, we're actually going to go to Faison. So it's actually, we're going to skip one down. We'll be coming back to Lexsop. So Faison, are you guys are ready to go? Okay.
Thanks. Thank you. Okay, guys, you absolutely need to hear about Faison. It's wireless earbuds guaranteed not to fall out. Good. So I'm sure you guys can all rely on these pictures. Earbuds are a total mess. I mean, they get tangled, they fall out, they limit your movements. So 2 years ago, when I had this idea, I said, okay, let's look out on the market if there's something available for that. So I did some online research, and I was not satisfied with what was on the market at that time. So there were those wireless solutions, they say, but they still have some kind of wires behind the neck, which is not comfortable, neither aesthetic. So I said, okay, let's move on. I hired an industrial designer. We made some sketches, concept 3D print prototypes, a lot of them actually. And I'm pretty proud to present you today Faison wireless earbuds. So those beauties have an unsurpassed battery life, up to 6 hours of continuous playtime. It's basically a one-size-fits-all. So yeah, no one thought this was possible, but we made it with hundreds of 3D print prototypes. From teenagers to seniors, they're guaranteed to fit and not fall out. Last but not least, they are fully waterproof. So yes, fully waterproof. You can go in your pool and have some doing some laps in your pool while listening to music, and it's going to be all fine. So we have a good idea, good product. What do we do next? Well, we launch a crowdfunding campaign. So in 60 days, we raised 2.2 million in pre-sales. 60 days. And actually the first day, we raised $100,000. And with no media exposures, absolutely no media exposure. So I think you can feel there's a lot of traction and a big market coming from this kind of product. And yeah, so for our first year, we'll close approximately 4 million in pre-sale. I think you like the curve out there, right? So the second year is going to be 12 million. And by the end of the third year, it's going to be 60 million. So what's the business model here? Simple. It's online and offline retail, and also our own transactional website. So right now, we 60 distributors reach out to us by themselves, and they're really excited. We're actually negotiating with them, and in a few days, we'll be signing up. So the response is just amazing. And of course, there's some early competition. This is a completely new segment, so there's two other competitors, but we're by far the most convenient. And just to give you a glimpse of the market, so what I'm showing you to guys, it's the wireless audio product. So it's not the truly wireless earbuds market. And just by that, you can see there's the growth is just phenomenal. It's at 6 billion right now, and it's going to be at 14 billion in 2 years. And the market for the truly wireless earbuds, the growth is just going to be out of this world, for sure. So right now, the timing is just incredible. Everyone has their smartphone, they're listening to music with streaming, and it's just, and Bluetooth has come a long way, and it's really, it's a lot better technology than it was. We have a patent pending on the form factor and on design as well, so we're likely secure on that part, because we feel the wireless earbuds industry is, it's critical to have a good fit. Hey, you want to do sports and fear that your earbuds might fall off. So we spent a lot of time refining that concept, and we made it. And we got some crazy tech skills in the team. Let me show you. So you can see Sylvain and Fred are the two engineers on board. They're just developing insane amount of technology in there. It's just amazing. No one actually thought what we're doing right now is possible, but we made it. It's really something, guys. You wouldn't believe what's going on. And there's Maxine doing the design, and me basically the sales guy and the accounting part of it. So what we've done so far, we made the proof of concept. We launched on November the crowdfunding campaign. We established a supply chain in February. And by the way, it's going to be built in Canada. Yeah, we're pretty proud of that. And it's not that expensive, let me tell you. So, and in just a few days, actually, I had a phone call 2 hours ago, and we got our functional prototype ready, so we're almost set. So right now, we're raising $750,000 in order to generate enough cash flow to go on retail, hire new employees to manage the operations. And yeah, that's it. Thank you, guys. Yes.
Now it works. Okay, perfect. So I've been lucky enough to work with a few companies that have done successful crowdfunding campaigns, and one of the key hiccups that they have and where they fail is actually delivering the product. So you said 2 hours ago that you got the first
fully
project, but on your timeline it says that February you had the whole supply chain put together. There's a little bit of a disconnect in my mind, and I just want to understand, you know, where are you in terms of manufacturing at scale, and what does the actual deliverable timeline look like for those 11,000 crowdfunded earbuds look like?
Okay, so for our manufacturing capabilities, we're in the process of selecting the main manufacturer, so, and they're all going to be built in Canada. So we, the batch of early, the advanced working prototypes, there's three manufacturers that we just want to make sure which one is the best. And, but it's basically going to be one of those three. And those guys can actually make over 80,000 units a month. So it's really not a big deal for that. We can handle that part really well. And you mentioned a good point, delivering on Kickstarter or Indiegogo, it can be an issue, of course. And it might be because of my accounting career, so I'm really steady on the spending amount. I'm really, really low, just hiring just enough so we can do what we do. So at this point, we set up the first batch of shipment we set, it was on July. And we had another batch on September. So at this point, we'll need to test a bit more the prototypes. So July is going to be really a tight schedule. We might not be able to make it, but we're clearly confident that we can make it for September.
That's okay, by the way. Nobody in crowdfunding history with a complex like machine like that, with our experience and in general, has ever been able to deliver on time. So don't worry about that. But it's actually delivering it. That's the big issue.
That's the point. And there's, I mean, we hire a senior engineer, Sylvain, and he's doing amazing work, so we really feel secure that we're definitely going to ship this product, no matter what. Yes? Right. So our cost is $50 per earbud set. Canadian. And we sell it 200 US. So that's approximately $220, the retail price. Yes.
Just to understand, you mentioned that you can swim with it, but how do you listen to music? If I have my iPhone, I don't swim with my iPhone. So well, how I connect the music if I want to swim?
Yeah, right. So no, iPhones are not yet waterproof, but some other smartphones are. But we don't want you guys to swim with your phones, of course. So what you can do is actually put your phone in the middle, let's say, of the pool, and you can reach with the Bluetooth distance, you can reach the whole pool with that.
Can you have a memory in that? Can I upload songs in the earbuds directly?
No, not yet. That's something we'll develop further along.
Hi. Hi. Did you complete the complete development of your product, the miniaturization of what you show there?
Yeah, it's complete.
It's complete. Okay. Then I've got a second question. I backed the Revels earbud campaign.
Yeah.
Did I make a mistake? If so, why?
Well, I mean, I met the Revel guys. They're great guys. So, and I think they've got a good product, of course. But I just feel it's, first Revel as a wire behind the neck. So that's something that really set us apart from them. I didn't test it. It seems good. But it's just, I think at this point, it's just a different market. They're still in the wired headphones market, and we're in the truly wireless headphones market. So you didn't make a mistake, but if you don't back us, you make a mistake.
Okay, one more question.
Does anybody on the team have experience defending the patent of something like this, which I would assume that's your one fear because it's such a cool product, it goes in the water, it looks good, it fits every year. So, but you can reverse engineer it, I assume, and copy it with the right people. And that's, I guess, going to be a big part of the business. What's your plan on that? What's your strengths on that? And how do you see that playing out, basically?
Right. So, yeah, we've got two patents. And, of course, what's the value of a patent? It's when you actually go to court and defend that. So, we're still in the process of securing that patent, but from the attorney we have, one is based in Cleveland, he feels pretty confident that we'll get it. And at that point, we'll just see how the competitors go out. But really, something it's for the truly wireless earbuds, having that fit is critical, and we have it. So we're basically ready to go in court if somebody copies it, of course.
All right. Thank you so much.
Sure.
So up next we have Lexop. Yes. And so here's your clicker. Yeah. Do you guys want to go on stage? So the timer is going to be here.
Thank you.
Hi everyone. Can everybody hear me? Good. Excellent. Hi everyone. My name is Amir. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Lexop, the most intuitive file sharing notification solution. And here's the problem. Large, sensitive, confidential document exchange is a big hassle. The go-to platform is email, but it simply doesn't meet market needs. The current enterprise file sharing and storage solutions don't integrate well with professional, fast-paced, regulated workflows. So in other words, professionals need a simple, tailor-made file sharing solution. And that's where we come in. Our users can share large files effortlessly, as simple as email, but with the security and efficiency of Lexop. And there's zero learning curve, because everything is done straight from Outlook or via their online dashboard. But what really makes us unique is our notification feature. As soon as you send an email, a document, an attachment, Lexop generates instantly a confirmation report, a proof of notification, which details your transmission. And this notification feature is a jewel for industries that have to give or
Saint Dominic. Everyone, take a seat. Everybody. People in the back, not sure. Please take a seat. All right. So we're ready for you. So up next, we have the next live pitch is Geeker. So give him a round welcome of applause. Yeah.
Thank you. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Yeah, it's good. All right. So our company, Geeker, is the online platform that helps Chinese foreign students find apartments in Montreal. Through our online platform, our users and clients will be able to find apartments and book online. The reason why we chose Chinese foreign students as a market is because with the minimum of resources, we can actually provide the maximum value. Now, obviously, our eventual idea is to move onto the real estate market as a whole. Now, the current market size, we're talking about 80,000 Chinese foreign students that comes to Canada every single year, with 12,000 of them in Montreal alone, and more than 300,000 of them that comes to North America every single year. As of right now, completely forgot, it's not connected. So as of right now, the current market situation is absolutely horrible for them to find an apartment. First of all, they have language barrier, they have culture barrier, they don't use Kijiji, they don't use Craigslist, and they don't trust these sources. So for them, they would go on to some community Chinese websites to find apartments, and beyond that, they have absolutely no service. So the way to solve this problem is to build a platform that does everything, from search all the way to finding roommates, customer support, verifying the apartment, all the way to booking. So with Geeker.com, we have personalized search experience, helping landlords have the intuitive property management system, and as well as safe and reliable online transactions. In terms of competition, by focusing only on Chinese foreign students, we have effectively eliminated immediate competition such as Kijiji and Craigslist, and bring our competition only to the local Chinese community websites. And obviously, we have a major competition which is located in China, who expanded into five countries. However, we think we do have a much stronger competitive advantage. For example, we're closer to the customers. We're located in Montreal in North America, as well as we focus on rental only at this moment. But most importantly, it's our team background. Including myself, most of my team are either Chinese immigrants or foreign students. Now, we used to be clients ourselves, so we understand the market, and most importantly, we understand our customers. So since the start of our operations last year in April, we have generated more than $200,000 of revenue so far, and we have $100,000 of pre-booking. By this time next year, we will generate more than $1 million in revenue. And at this point, we have a functional website. However, we don't have all the features we want. We have the feature of obviously posting and looking for apartments, and we're also building Android and iOS prototype at the same time. So by this time next year, we will be expanded into three cities and with many, many features. Since last year, we started with a team of five. This year, we grew to a team of 11. I used to work for Flatbook, and before that, I was taking care of their revenue, data analysis and sublet inventory acquisition. And before that, my background was mathematics, computational finance. My CTO, lead developer, is currently working at Nuance as a senior mobile developer. I can't afford him full-time right now, but he will be on board at the end of the summer. So here's our three-year plan. This year, we're still focusing on Montreal as the market. Last year, we had around 70 clients. This year, we will have more than 500. As of this moment, since mid-March, we already have 115, so 500 as a target is a very reachable target, since September is by far our peak season. When I'm talking about clients, I'm not talking about users on our website. When I'm talking about people that comes to us, ask us to find them an apartment, ask us to visit their apartment, so these are people that actually pay. And by 2018, we will be looking at 15,000 potential clients and revenue of $12 million. Now, how do we get there? So obviously, we're going to be expanding in Toronto and ideally either Boston or Vancouver, but that's something we're still discussing next year, and moving into 10 cities by 2018. In terms of technology, we will definitely have payments, community, because you know finding a home isn't just about the physical home itself, it's also providing them a community where they can communicate and have activities outside of their apartment. So I'm just gonna skip the slides because the time is very short. So how did I come up with the revenue projection? Basically, we're talking about 15,000. Well, right now we have 500 clients, and our conversion rate to revenue is only 10%. Why? Because a lot of times right now we have way more clients than inventory. So a lot of times when a client comes to us, they say, "Hey, get us an apartment within a week." So we have to negotiate the deal with the landlord, and sometimes we say, "You know what? We don't make money this year." But you know, next year when more client come, we will be able to generate more revenue since we will have more inventory. So by 2018, we know that for sure when all the payments go through our platform, the conservative conversion rate that we'll give is 2/3 of them. But actually, if you think about it, if everyone has to pay through our platform, this number is very conservative. And we're talking about 1,000 in average per year that each client pays us. Right now we're at 1,200, but we can definitely drop that. So those are the revenue from online services. So right now, yes, we do generate a lot of service, but we still focus a lot of offline service. You know, we hire marketing people, customer service, but the idea is to use that experience and transform that into a platform, transform that into technology that can scale. As you can see, by 2018, the percentage of our revenue from online service will be more or north of 75%. So why am I here today? Because we're looking for funding. We think that with an investment will help us solve the cash flow problem and also grow at a much faster pace. Sure, we're self-sufficient as of right now, but if we want to dominate the market, we need to move fast and we need cash to boost this growth. So we're looking at a $2 million investment for the next 18 months. Thank you.
Yes, sorry. Just one question. For now, the process of finding an apartment for you guys is manual. So you have people who you negotiate with the landlords, and then eventually you match them. How do you scale that process into a venture backable business that's worth investing $2 million right now?
So what happens is when we approach landlords or when we approach big buildings, they actually love our business. Why? Because we expose them to a market they have never accessed before. But the problem, the reason why we're doing unscalable way right now is because what we discover is when you approach big buildings, such as those big buildings near Concordia, the quality versus price is not ideal for our customers. So in order to build like a long-term relationship with our customers and not necessarily the property managers, we choose to find them a better unit that's suitable for them. There are many buildings that want to do business with us. Unfortunately, their price and their quality isn't up there for our clients. But we believe that, like you know, with a better business team, with more money, we can hire higher like talents that are able to acquire many more quality properties for us. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, well,
and also partnerships with brokers, obviously.
I have a condo downtown at Place des Arts, basically, that I'm renting to a Saudi Arabian guy who's paying me good money, you know, $1,500. But I would rather rent it to a Chinese guy if he was paying me, you know, $1,700. So what would be the process for a guy like me, of owner of just one, you know, quote unquote investment property?
So as of right now, since we don't have the payment processing feature on our website, if people want just to put up their ad on our website, they can definitely do it, and we don't charge them. But if you don't speak Chinese, which I don't think you do, then you would come to us, and we would translate the everything, and we would push that towards our clients, and usually would take a service fee from that.
How much would it be?
Well, in average, I'd say around $1,200.
Me to pay you $1,200 to translate it in Chinese?
Well, the service does not only include that. So what we do is something called a market arbitrage. So basically, most of our clients are willing to pay a much higher fee than the market price. So when we approach landlords, if they don't want to give us a certain fee, we can say, hey, look, or which we are doing, by the way, you know, where our clients are willing to pay at the certain fee, so, you know, charge them this much, and we will take whatever the extra or a little bit less than the extra. This will not only generate more income for them, it also boost up the value of their property. So most of the time, they will say yes to this.
But would the $1,200 be upfront from the landlord?
Or absolutely.
Okay, so but later is there a guarantee of getting the tenant at a higher rate or no?
Pardon?
Is there a guarantee of getting the tenant paying you the higher rent that
you're getting previously? We only take the fee when the tenant signs a lease.
Okay, so it's not upfront then. Oh, well, it's upfront when it's signed.
Exactly.
I see.
Yeah. And also, going forward, obviously, we will take a commission or no service fee on top of each transaction. So we don't actually want to take the upfront model going forward, going to our online platform. It's something that will be gradually, it's a gradual income instead of a... But you see, these things are the reason why we're doing offline service. Because it's by doing these offline service that we truly find out what is suitable for the market, what is suitable for the landlord, and what is suitable for our clients. So it's by doing this, we will come up with a product that is suitable for everyone.
All right, thank you so much.
Sorry.
So up next, we have Mike Lee, president of Fundica and R&D Partners. Mike has spent the last 15 years, he's an engineer. He's spent the last 15 years as well in M&A experience and helping startups getting funded. He has extensive experience in R&D tax credit as well as government funding. So please give a warm welcome of applause to Mike Lee / my boss.
So yeah, I pay Lana a lot to say all these things, which... well, I hope you have a nice day. It is Friday the 13th, but it seems like the weather is getting better on us. So what I have here is really, this is a presentation. It's a bit of a more of like a one-on-one on funding. So the front row here, you guys, you've probably seen a lot of this. And in fact, if there's any other comments or things you disagree with, please let me know right away. So the five W's of funding. So these are kind of things I've seen over the years, as Lana mentioned. So my background, I'm an engineer. I'm also an MBA, CFA, and I worked with a lot on the M&A side, and over the last while, more on the funding side. So the first thing, and this really comes from a VC called Jeff Klaviyer in the US. He kind of came out with the beginning of this, and I kind of added on to it. The question I often get, and when I go to these roadshows, people say, are we fundable? You know, is my company fundable? And most businesses are not, and then what I see, especially startup ones. But if you are, there's really a rule, and it's called, you can call it the three asses. I'm going to expand it here to the four asses. So do you have the four asses? So the first thing is, you know, do you have a smart-ass team? That by far is the most important thing. I've seen projects get invested in that I thought it was a stupid idea. I thought it was really, there's no market. But the team had already exited three or four ventures. It didn't matter what they said, investors are in. They didn't care. They know whatever these guys do somehow turns to gold. So that is by far the most important thing. So smart ass team. So if you're really not a smart guy, you're not really well connected, but you may have some good ideas, try to find this really smart ass type of person to join your team. The second thing is kind of a kick-ass product. So you want something that is, you know, makes sense, people get it. Some investors will be looking for things that have nice deep moats around them, as we saw today, or IP. Other ones, it's just really innovative and you feel you're really far ahead in terms of the innovation curve. But something that really makes a difference. It's not just, oh, we've seen that, you know, 100 times already. The third thing, and there are certain investors that go after this, is they want a big-ass market. So, and that is amazingly different in Canada than the U.S. from what I've seen. When you pitch at these kinds of events in Canada, you know, it goes fine. People say, you know, I'm trying to get to 100 million in revenue, 50 million in revenue, you know, even 20 or 10 million, fine. The winner today and the winner from all the other stops, when you go down to the U.S. guys, and in fact, when you go to the U.S., some of the VCs are actually born in Canada, but they all say the same thing. They say, listen, you know, we want billion-dollar markets. We want not just 50 or 100 million. We want, you know, huge amounts. And they're right. That's what they need. They have large funds. They need to return the investment on each, return the entire fund potential on each investment. So they're going after the big, big fish. And that's all they want. They don't want to have anything to do with anything small. So when you're doing that, you do need a big-ass market. Depending on who you're speaking to, you may need a super big-ass market. And the last thing, which is a little known secret, and this is kind of part added, is you need a thick-ass wallet. So right from the start, you're not going to get very far if you got no cash. So either some of the partners are working, your parents gave you some money, you somehow did well in the past. You need some money. You need something to burn. Otherwise, the business just, you're doing it, you know, for 2 hours or 3 hours every night. You're not getting anywhere. So you need a little bit of cash so you can devote it to kind of resources. In some cases, I've seen founders, they're typically not the ones to pitch here, they don't actually do any work. They're just busy on their day job, but they're making their $100,000 or $200,000, and they got a few subcontractors or salary people who are actually doing the work. That kind of works for a while, but at least they've got flow. At least they got that thick-ass wallet to make it happen. So if you don't have all four of these things, your chances are low, and really these are the factors we come to. People talk about them different ways, but I think the way I like to best say it is, do you have... You know, do you have the asses to make it happen? So are you fundable? So that's the first thing. So if you are, you know, where do you find the funding? So this is kind of going through W. So this is a little bit about Fundica, and I'm kind of explaining about it to be kind of straight up. So what we have in Fundica, it's really a database of all the different funding sources out there, be it grants, tax credits, loans, equity, the like. And it's really what we call traditional funders. So we're not talking about angel or individuals. We have like Ange Quebec and the different angel groups, but we don't have individuals. If you want to look at that, there's AngelList. They do a great job on that. If you want to look more at the traditional funders, you go there. You go in there. So you really see it right across the whole range from the government ones to the private sector ones. And when you're in the government ones, you see the local ones, you see the provincial ones, the federal ones, not just, you know, federal or provincial. We've also added advisors, so people can add their advisor as well. So this is how it all goes in. How does it stay up to date? We really have three different ways it happens. We have funders that come in, and now we have several hundred funders that go in and update their programs. We have bots, one that does discovery, so it goes out and tries to find new funding programs. A second one that tracks existing programs to see if they have changed or not. So we have these bots, and we also have a research team. So there's kind of manual process behind that. Part of that is actually done in Canada. Part of it we've actually offshored now. So that's how we kind of put that all together, and the other end is the entrepreneur. So the idea is to make it really easy, really make it a place where people go to find it. It's not the only place. You'll see later on there's concierge. They have smaller a database of some of the programs or some other places, but and there that's good as well. We're trying to make it as easy as possible to do. So that's a place to find funding. And certainly, most of all, what I really want to make sure is that people don't just say, you know what, I heard of Emploi Québec. I'm going to go call them, meet with them, do all these things. Just go off on a tangent, you know, one at a time. I've met entrepreneurs. They've come in. They said, I met Emploi Québec, and then I met the fisheries has some grant program. But you're not even doing anything with fish. He's like, yeah, but I heard they had a lot of money. He's like, come on, you know. But they just go off on tangents, all right? Some of the funders here have awesome programs, by the way, too. So they're there. But make sure you kind of look at what's the best ones for me. You know, and depending on your business, there's a lot of different options, so get the best ones for you. And in some cases, you may quickly realize there may not be any programs for me, but at least you know. So kind of figure that out up front before you go through all the application process and meeting process and the like. And particularly when you come to things like loans and equity, do a lot of research there, because even if you meet the right person, if you haven't actually researched them before, figure out how they are the right person, you kind of blow that opportunity. So it's one place to find it. So when you do go into it, the next thing people kind of say is, what's the difference? So this is a bit of a 101, especially for the first row here, but how does it work? You know, tax credits, there's no heart and soul in tax credits. It's all by the law. I don't care if you like, if the government likes you, doesn't like you, you're a nice guy, you're trying to save the world, whatever. It's predefined. It's all in the tax code. So you got to figure out exactly what's going on in the tax code and how to kind of get the most out of it. So another group, R&D partners out here, who I'm, you know, full disclosure, also associated with. That's what they do it very well, but that's just by the law. There's no real emotion there. The second thing is grants. So grants is where you kind of get into, they're doing it for a societal benefit. They're trying to make Canada a better place, economically and for other reasons. So you really want to make it better. How does it work? You got to get in line. You got to know where to get in line, when to get in line, and you got to know which kind of strings to pull on. So it's very different from tax credits. It's really about being at the right place, right time, and knowing how to draw on that. So I've seen people get, you know, grants for, I know some people have this, you know, there's certain programs that get grants for, and it's like, how in the world did they get that grant? That's a research grant in an extremely very fine defined area. They're not in that area. They're not doing research, and it's very upfront. Sometimes people get in there, so it's kind of, there is a lot more leeway possible. Having said that, you know, by the most part, you do your homework, you get the results. Public loans, similar to grants. A lot of these you don't have to pay back, but you know, the idea is that you have a business, you are going to pay them back, kind of going along. They'll kind of look at more broadly as well. They want to make sure there's a capability to pay it back. There's a lot of loans where, unless they really see it possible, they won't lend it. You know, Futurepreneur is kind of one of those ones that takes more risks. There's loans related to R&D tax credits that take a little more risk, but they're actually more, there's public and private on that, but that's kind of the loan side on the public loan. As far as private loans, now you're kind of going to the private sector, now they want to make money. But a really big difference happens between the loans and the venture capital. The loans, they want to make sure they have some assets to go back to, or that you have very good cash flow. If you don't have very good cash flow or assets, skip this step, you know, onto the next one. So for the most part, although private sector loans is probably the biggest money kind of used in terms of funding in the economy, for startups, it often is not something that's accessible. The next one is angel investors. So angel investors, there's a whole kind of different flavor to them. They want to be able to believe in you. They want to put some money in and know that, okay, I think there's a chance for me to get it out. But there, a lot of them will take a lot of risk. They'll start pretty early on. What I see with some of them is they really want to stick to sectors they've invested in or themselves have actually been, you know, worked in. If they've actually worked in that sector, your chances go up tremendously. If they've invested before in it and they know they can make money in it, again, they go up pretty high. If it's very different from what they've been in, it's probably not the right person to be speaking to for the most part. So that's the angel investors. And then the one at the bottom, and I guess fortunately Alex is not in the room right now, but Edward is venture capitalists. So venture capitalists, that's the last group you want to go to. And not because they're not nice guys, but because they're certainly the most demanding. They expect a very high return. They're really going to get involved in your business. They're going to be there the whole way through. And for the most part, unlike the angels, they're going to try to go in a little bit later, so a little bit more in the traction phase. Some of them start pretty early. Some of them will go in much, much later, but they're generally just a little further along. And really, you know, that's kind of, in some ways, the funder of last resort when it comes to, you know, startups and certainly any kind of business, because they are the most demanding. So as much as it's great to have venture capitalists involved and it sounds great, it certainly is one you want to think a lot before you actually do it. Just going to grab a sip of water here. So those are the different types of funding that are available. So if we just do a quick example, just to show you what it's like, if you actually went to find funding, you go into Fundica, you'll put in a bit of information here, and then you'll kind of see, you know, these are the ones we consider to be the favorites. So if you go in, you'll actually see what types of funding we would suggest for you. And then there's grants, tax credits, loans, loan guarantees, equity, and we have advisors. So this is based on the information you put in. The more different filters you kind of go into and say yes or no, or what kind of thing you want, the more information I'll give you. Fundica, to be fair, is an identification tool. It's not going to help you do the application. It's going to show you, you know, where the applications will be. So in this case here, we're doing MyTax. You click on it, you'll go and you'll see a little, you know, what the program is about, the limits, the eligibility, some contact information. And, you know, it'll help you go to the website and do the thing. The application, you really still need to do yourself. So this is really the first step in the process. So it doesn't, you know, make your life, it doesn't do anything for you, but it identifies, hopefully, the right ones. So that's the kind of thing you look at. And when you look at a typical funding program, these are the things to look at. Okay, how much is it, you know, what is it about? Do I actually fit into it? How much are you getting? Some grants, you know, it may not be worth you even looking at them. If you're a large company and it's a $500 grant, for the most part, they're just going to say it's going to cost us more than $500 to do it. So make sure there's a return on investment. Other ones, they may fund types of things that you're not actually not going to be investing in. You know, if they're investing in buildings or capital or things like that, and that's not what you're doing, it's not for you. In some cases, they'll help you with travel and things like that. Again, are you going to be traveling or not? So make sure you kind of fit into everything that they're looking for and everything that really makes sense for you. So this is kind of my next slide, and for me, this is, I think, the most important one of all. It really explains to me, you know, and really kind of, to me, makes it systematic. So when you actually go through funding, it's really important that you're systematic for so many reasons. And it means that you really go through the steps and you don't just jump right to, okay, I want some VC capital, I'm going to go talk to Edward here. That's really what you don't want to be doing, and that's really a big mistake. So the first thing is really product market fit. And in today's world, there's easy ways to get some at least initial kind of validation. Is there product market fit? But that's the first thing you should look at. You know, and it's pretty easy to determine, is the market really large enough for me to have any kind of, you know, serious impact on it? So that's the first thing. And I unfortunately meet entrepreneurs that have not gone there. They're like, I have an idea. I go talk to a VC. It's like, okay, you've skipped all the steps. You're going around the, you know, monopoly board, but somehow you think you got a, you know, card right to go to the end. It doesn't work well like that, and it doesn't work at all. The second thing is the core team. So, and I think that even going to accelerators today, they're going to say you need to be at least one, you know, technical person and at least one business person. So, and frankly, that makes a lot of sense. So you want to have a core team, at least two, if not three. Several reasons. First of all, generally two or three people are much smarter than one. If one of the person, you know, gets hit by a bus, the business is still going. But for the most part, I think it just goes to show that even if you look back in history, all these very, very, very successful companies, there's always a team. You hear about the Bill Gates, the Zuckerberg, but if you dive even a little deeper, there is lots of co-founders around. The third thing is the cash in hand. So that comes back to the thick-ass wallet. So you need a little bit of money. So before you really dive into this and say, I'm going to really commit some time, make sure you have a little bit of money. You know, make sure you keep this going. And again, it can come from different places. So it can be love money. It can be angel money. It could just be somebody in the team working and keeping the whole thing going while the rest of you are actually doing the new business. So in terms of the funding world, I would say that's kind of the pre-funding step, but very, very important to remember and to go through this. And if at any point you say no, you just stop. That's it, you know? If you got nothing else to do at night and I'm like, I haven't been able to hit these stops, go have fun. Don't waste your time, all right? Because I see people, you know, go really, really hard at this, but there's still one person, they haven't validated the market, they're killing themselves, and, you know, they're not going to get any funding. So, you know, unfortunately, you know, go back a few steps on the board and start back at the beginning. Once you have that, then go through the next step. So the first thing is go for the government funding. It's the cheapest one, so that's why you should go there first. It lends some validation, most of the companies I see that got some, you know, VC funding have probably already gotten government funding. It has some validating to it. It's, hey, someone's already in here. If I put in a dollar and government's already put in 50 cents, I'm already kind of leveraging on that. So government funding is a good place to start. Also, you may make some mistakes when you do the government funding, in which case you'll kind of learn from those mistakes, hopefully, when you go to the next thing. Next thing is go for the bank one. Again, if you don't have cash flow, and that's kind of regular cash flow going on, or you have some assets, just skip this step because you're not going to get any private sector loans. You may get some public ones, but we'll consider that to be government funding. And the last step, if you really have to and you really have a business, you've gotten through all these steps and it still makes sense, go see the venture capitalists. But again, they're going to be expensive, so they're going to ask for a lot. And we actually had a presentation, was it 2 years ago, by a VC who actually came up and said, why not to take money from a venture capitalist? And he gave you all these reasons why you should not take it. And if you actually said, okay, I agree with all that, I'll live with all that, then you could take it. And I think that's truly the way it is. So that's kind of the last step. So the angel or the VC. So be systematic. That's the idea here. This is pretty straightforward, but just be systematic as you go through it. So how to get funded? I think we've heard from a few different panels today. We kind of learned from the questions and answers as well. Be systematic. Go from government funding to banks to VC. Whenever you go talk to a funder, make sure you really understand who they are, what they're looking for. It's so easy to do the research today between LinkedIn, AngelList, Unspace, so much on the web. Learn what they're doing. Learn what's in their portfolio. Not only do you kind of pick the right ones and go to the right ones, it kind of makes them feel like you actually care about them when you go to them and say, oh, I hear you've also invested in this company and that company, and you seem to like older entrepreneurs that do wacky things, maybe like me, that kind of stuff really goes a long way. So really understand and target your funders, particularly in certain sectors. So I see some companies come to the roadshow, and if you're in cleantech, cleantech's very special. There's really like four VCs across Canada that really are the ones who invest in cleantech. It's not most VCs. In terms of angels, it's again a small handful that actually do that kind of thing. So pick those ones. If you're looking at payment processing, there's certain individuals and VCs that will look at that. If you're in other sectors, so figure out who they are. Next thing is put together a killer application pitch. It's kind of a no-brainer, but do it. I see people who don't really do it. I was in a panel in Toronto a couple months ago, and the company had gotten several hundred thousand in funding. And the guy got up there and he said, before I actually pitched the first time, I practiced my pitch in front of 250 different people individually. So it seemed like crazy, but actually the guy had a really good pitch, and I guess he'd practiced it a lot. And he said, it seems like a lot of people, but it really wasn't that hard. I'd meet people and I'd give them my pitch. I'd meet someone else and give them my pitch. And so practice it. Get it down pat. Don't just wing it. And I think the more you practice it, the better you'll get, even if it's good to start with. And then develop a win-win relationship. So when you actually, speak to an investor, it shouldn't be you're asking, you're begging. And at the same time, so you shouldn't be speaking up to them. And at the same time, you shouldn't be speaking down to them either. Hey, I got the greatest thing. You better be in. Or you're nothing. You really have to be on the same level. It's like any kind of relationship. You really have to kind of relate to them and they relate to you if you want it to work. And then moving the deal to close. So this is something that's an art. Some people are better at it than others, but really kind of getting it to close. Sometimes it needs a little trigger. Hey, we got this opportunity. We need the money, a reason to actually happen. We have some other investors. We have certain employees we want to hire, certain, perhaps other government programs, things that may be happening that you need to get the deal to close by, but moving it to close. So these are kind of steps I've seen and I hear about, and I've been involved in the past to some degree with. So how to get funded. So we kind of looked at this a bit before, types of funding. So tax credits, grants. Grants are always for a certain societal reason or a purpose, so either kind of generally purpose. The loan guarantees the equity. Just to summarize, I think Yo's going to go through this a little more, but these are some of the programs we typically see, particularly in if you go into kind of government programs, these are kind of government ones we see the most. So people often ask about these kinds of things. So these are the programs we see. And that's it. So that's kind of a little bit of fun on Funding 101. I hope it was helpful. I think some people may have a very good idea, and hopefully this was just interesting to hear some stories on. Others, I hope this was something new that will help you going forward. So thank you very much. So I have, it's on the slideshare already, but we can add it for some. Okay, people asked about the slide. So this slide is actually on slideshare right now, but we'll put it up again along with any of the other presenters that come along that like their presentation up. Some choose not to, but I think IBM asked for it before, and others as well. So we'll put on SlideShare, and we'll make it available from the FundicaRoadshow.com site. So next, Alex from AirTerra.
Hi, everyone. Do I have a clicker? I don't have a clicker. Okay, so hi, I'm Alex, I work with a company called AirTerra. I'm excited to talk to you today about our new product, Soil Matrix. But first, we have a problem with carbon in our atmosphere, as you may know, but what you didn't know is we're actually lacking carbon in our soils. So one of the ways that forest fires heal after a forest fire, some of the charcoal that's produced in the fire gets worked into the ground and helps create a good environment for the soil to rehabilitate. So a few years later, that's what the forest floor looks like. You can see it's regrowing, and this is due in part to the charcoal that was created in the fire. So we have a lack of balance between our atmosphere and our soils. What if there was a way to bring them back into equilibrium? Well, there is. So our solution is Soil Matrix Biochar. It's essentially a compound of specialized charcoal made with waste wood. And essentially, when you work into the ground, it essentially creates the perfect environment for the beneficial microbes and fungi that plant roots love and need to grow. As well, because we're effectively diverting carbon from the atmosphere, putting it in the ground and using it to grow plants, our entire process is considered carbon negative. But why do farmers want it? Well, biochar has been shown to improve crop yields. It's been by retaining water, nutrients, and fertilizer, enhancing the value of the soil over the long term and cutting long-term costs. The market for this product in the United States is growing very quickly. It's got 17% growth over the next 7 years. Many new entrants. Meanwhile, in Canada, there's been absolutely no growth. In fact, there is no market because of the long approval times put forward by the Canadian Food Inspection Agency for new agriculture products. So we are the first company in Canada with approval from the CFIA to sell biochar to the Canadian market, making us the first entrant to the market and meaning we effectively have no competition right now. So we're acting right now today as a wholesale importer, selling to several different early adopters as we begin to develop the market in Canada. But the dream or the goal to have happen soon is to become the first manufacturer of a biochar blended soil product. In doing this, we can leverage several different revenue streams, including sales of carbon credits, collection of tipping fees from collecting people's waste wood, as well as typical product sales. In the future, there are a lot of different applications in development for biochar. One of the most interesting ones being tar sands cleanup. Should the policy approvals go through for that, our demand would grow quite a lot. We'd go from selling the little boxes we sell today to moving train loads. We're looking for capital investment right now. We're working with several different grant agencies who are very interested in working with us. So any investment would be matched by any of those the agencies that are interested right now. We need to purchase a bunch of production facility and site equipment as well as we have quite a few R&D marketing costs as we set up our new business. The whole point of this is to bring an optimized blend of biochar blended soils to the Canadian market that's tailored perfectly for the consumers, landscapers, and farmers we aim to target. These are some of the production facilities we're currently evaluating, the most interesting being NextChar and IRSI. They're commissioning their systems right now, and so we're keeping a close eye on what they're doing. Robert Lavoie is our CEO and founder. He's flanked by Claude Lavoie. He has decades of experience in the carbon capture and sequestration industry. Claude Lavoie is a successful entrepreneur in the logistics, dry bulk transportation space. Myself and Tim are both business students who are very passionate about this eco-friendly environmental product, as well as Joe Nicholas, who's helping with the development on the product side. Our project is based mainly in Alberta, so I'm the only person in Montreal right now, so that's why I was here today, and not the rest. Here's a financial projection over the next 5 years. Note that in year two, we make a $1 million capital investment, and our COGS decrease a lot as we will have production at that time. Here is a projection of the value we think we can create. I think that's conservative, as well as some of the breakdown, a breakdown of some of the investments we will have to make. We've always been a socially minded enterprise. We helped do development work in Kenya, actually brought better cooking technology through clean cooking stoves that produce biochar for their crops. We're currently working with IRAP and the AITF to get a $100,000 grant. We are looking for funds to get matched through those companies or agencies. And we're also looking for a $1 million investment to purchase our production facility and begin making our soils. So thank you very much. I'm Alex, this is AirTerra. We're bringing the soil and the atmosphere into balance.
Hey, hi. How's it going?
Good.
Good. Do you have an existing company with your parents in this business at all, or is this entirely a startup?
This is a startup company. I'm not sure if I quite understand what you mean by this.
Because I saw 35 years of experience.
Okay,
and,
he's worked. It's right. My father is the founder of this company. He's worked in the oil industry, the carbon capture and sequestration side of that, for the past 35 years, and now is moving into this new business. AirTerra, yes.
And if you can go back to the slides, you projected the sales and then the value of the company, basically, if you go to the sales and the profit slide.
Yep.
Is this it here?
Yeah.
So year five, you're saying $2 million in revenues and $900,000 in EBT.
Sure.
And
yes.
Then the value of the company for that, you put how much?
$5.5 million.
$5 million. How do you justify like the multiple, basically, of saying more than five times, you know, the profits that you're doing? Why I ask, and it depends on the industry, but you know, between three to five is like already five is on the high end, you know, and you're clearly
okay.
Over.
Sure.
You know, without having the history of having the same performance for that long to justify
right.
a high multiple,
yeah.
Why do you think it's worth that much, basically?
Well, as I said, we're developing a new market in Canada. So I think that because this product hasn't arrived yet, there will be a very quick growth of people wanting this product, especially because of the added benefits and the fact that the government is looking for environmental friendly type products. So I think we'll get a lot of support. It's true that valuation may be a little high, but I think that it's realistic to get those kind of sales in 5 years from now, yes. Based on what I've seen in the American market also, that confirms some of the valuation we put.
Thanks.
Another question?
Yep.
You need a mic. You do need a mic.
Okay. I just want to clarify if I understood correctly. So initially what you're proposing is the company's going to be importing the material from...
That's what we're doing right now, yeah.
Okay. And then you're going to convert over to self-manufacturing.
That's correct.
Is there any differentiator at that point? So, or is it basically the same that you'd be importing?
No. So we recognize that the average consumer, the average person that would want to buy our product would probably prefer to buy a blended product. So we want to develop a blend of biochar, fertilizer, soil, planting soil, So that could be sold as one simple package to anyone who wants it. So after we get production, we want to develop the blending technologies. It's not that complicated to get that stuff because it's just a simple blender. But we need to be able to produce our own biochar. So yes, the product would be differentiated after having production means.
And if I guess one more question. Sure. So as a consumer, you're targeting consumers as
no,
well?
No, we want to reach landscapers, consumers, farmers.
Okay.
Yeah.
So why, just help me understand, why would I buy this product versus all the other ones out there today?
Well, I mean, we can make the argument that the long-term costs of using it, of having to replenish fertilizer that gets washed away, the value of the soils decrease. But when you use our product, the value of your soil can increase over time, and you can also save money from less watering, fertilizing costs or needs. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
All right, so our next presentation is from the NRC Concierge Service. So Jo Ersberge, I'm gonna tell us about the truth about government funding. So Jo, I'll let you take it away here.
Okay. Bon après-midi tout le monde. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Mike, for inviting me today to give a road talk, and also thank you, Mike, for your excellent previous presentation. Makes my life much easier, don't have to repeat a lot of things. My name is Jo. I'm also known as the government guy in the startup community. I basically work for the National Research Council of Canada, and I work for a service that's called Concierge in Innovation. And what we do at NRC is we try to connect companies, R&D-based tech companies, to all sorts of government funding provided by both the federal and the provincial government. But not just funding, also we also connect our entrepreneurs with universities, public research centers, and expertise, because there are thousands of researchers and expertise that are paid by public money and that can actually help entrepreneurs develop their ideas into marketable products. And so today I'm going to talk to you about the truth regarding government funding, at least the truth as how I see it, and what makes me an expert in government funding, you ask. Well, prior to joining the NRC in 2013, I actually ran my own company in the life sciences field. I ran my own company for about 13 or 14 years. And as a young entrepreneur then, we're talking 17 years ago, of course I had to raise money. So there were two ways how I raised money. The first one was through revenues from the get-go, get a lot of revenues, and then use government funding. So in the first 24 months, when I had my company, I raised about $600,000 or $700,000 just from government funding, and that makes me a sort of an expert in government funding. And that's why the government of Canada, when they created this concierge service, they hired me in order to help entrepreneurs like you access government funding. So as Mike clearly explained, there's a lot of ways you can fund a company. There's love money, the three Fs, the friends, fools, and family. Startup grants and competitions like Fondation Montréal Inc. There's angels and venture capital, which is not for every startup, as you know. There is debt financing. Unfortunately, I talk to a lot of entrepreneurs who are allergic to debt financing. They don't want to get any loans. But still, if you can, you know, create a good working relationship with a banker, it can be a great way to support your company and grow your company. There's a lot of successful businesses in Canada that are built almost exclusively based on debt financing. Here below, we have government types of funding that I will be discussing. So the government funding, that means tax credits, research grants, government loans and loan guarantees. That's what my startup benefited from mostly. And there's, of course, non-repayable contributions. What's the difference between a grant and a non-repayable contribution? A grant is something usually that you get upfront, while a non-repayable contribution is something you first have to spend the money, and then the government can give you some money back if you file, for example, a report. So there's a lot of ways to fund a startup, and that's good because startups have many needs, right? Some of you are looking just for the initial startup funding. Others are looking for working capital. You may want to
hire some personnel. You will have R&D activities, so you need to fund your research and development activities. Some of you are probably prototyping, need to purchase equipment like 3D printers, etc. Maybe you want to file a patent, hire some interns, and all of you, I hope, are looking for money for marketing and export in order to market your products abroad. So companies have many needs, and there are a lot of government programs that can meet those needs. But finding the right government funding program can be a bit of a challenge, right? Everybody who's tried to access government funding probably knows that. And the reason why I am saying that it's difficult sometimes to find government funding is because of this. So this is a bit of a complex slide, and that's on purpose. So there's a lot of government organizations out there. This is just the tip of the iceberg. And they all fund a whole range of activities. So if you're a small business and you want to buy some equipment, well, you can go and knock on the door of Canada Economic Development, because their website says they support, they can support you with purchase of equipment. There's Investissement Québec that has loan programs. Industry Canada has what it's called the Canada Small Business Financing Program. You can purchase equipment up to $350,000 and basically get an 85% loan guarantee. Then there's the BDC. I hope they can provide loans, right, for equipment. So there's a few government organizations that can help you with equipment. If you're doing R&D, you can go and knock on the door of the NRC IRAP program. The IRAP program, if you don't know what it is, it is the Industrial Research Assistance Program. It's actually the best-run government program in Canada for support for R&D. NSERC, the National Science and Engineering Research Council, has grants that can help companies do R&D. The Department of Defense has programs that can help you fund your R&D. Industry Canada has programs. The Canada Space Agency has programs. Canada Revenue Agency and Revenue Quebec have tax credits. So if you're doing R&D, you can have access to all those programs. The question is, which door are you going to knock on when? And what are all the eligibility criteria for all these different programs? And as a startup, can you benefit from all these programs or not? What is the way? How do you figure out how this works? And that's basically why the Concierge Service was created by the Government of Canada in December 2013. What I do as an innovation advisor, I talk to a company, can be 30 minutes, can be an hour and a half, can be a whole day. I want to find out what that company wants to do, where it is, where it wants to go, and I'll figure out which programs this company can use. And I'll explain him how the program actually works. And I will then refer that particular company to somebody within the government so that they can go and apply for funding. And it's a free service, by the way. So, but here at Concierge, we only deal with government funding programs, right? If you're looking for funding programs outside of government, there's also Fundica.com, as Mike explained. So we are not competitive to Fundica. We're complementary to Fundica. And I often tell my clients, have a look at our website and also have a look at the Fundica website, just to make sure that you actually know what's available in Canada in terms of funding. So there's a lot of programs. And in principle, all of you, you can access those programs. And I want to talk about 10 myths about government funding. There are a lot of more than 10 myths about government funding, but these 10 are basically 10 myths that I uncovered while working with companies. So I deal with about 400 to 450 companies on a yearly basis. Many of those are startups, and I've learned a few things because everybody who calls me, the first question they ask, is there a grant for me? And I'll tell you, how government thinks when you approach government as a startup. So myth number one, all government funding is in the forms of grants. Well, as Mike explained, the government offers a lot more than grants. There are non-repayable contributions. There are loans and loan guarantees, sometimes convertible debentures. So it's not just all grants, and think of that. If you approach government, there's a lot more than grants. And 9 times out of 10, when I'm being contacted by a company, I will guide them towards other sources than grants. There are hundreds of grants out there, something that I often hear. Actually, if you're a startup business and you want access funding, there aren't that many grants available. And often they are specifically geared towards specific industry, like IT or clothing or agriculture. And sometimes they're also for specific groups. So there are wage subsidies, which are specifically for youth under 30, postgraduate students. There are grants for women, there are grants for immigrants, so think of that if you approach the government and make sure you have a targeted group in mind. Myth number three, that's a good one. I have a brilliant idea, now I can surely get a government grant to fund it, right? So that's a typical entrepreneur in his basement who got this great idea for a business. He's not an entrepreneur yet, but this is a great idea. So he calls me up and says, can I get, please can you give me money for my business, for my idea? The fact of the matter is the government does not provide seed funding. Government is never a first investor in an idea. Government does fund ideas. We have universities for that, okay? Government sends its money to universities, and they come up with the ideas. But if you're an entrepreneur with an idea and you're trying to approach government to get a grant for it, it's very difficult. If you have an idea, the first thing you need to do is first put some skin in the game. You know, invest a bit in your company and execute on your idea. Make an MVP, a prototype if you can. Find investors first, show that there's somebody else who wants to share the risk and the costs with the government before you actually approach the government. Myth number four, grants are easy to get, right? It's just, you know, you file the form online and you send it to government, you're gonna get money. The thing is, many grants are extremely competitive and they all involve paperwork and may require significant lead time. If you're trying to hire somebody and you wanna obtain a subsidy, you know, a hiring subsidy for that, and you wanna hire him next week, well, you can forget about getting the subsidy. It may take a few weeks if you file the application before you actually receive the money. So take that into account. Myth number five, I don't have to contribute any money to get a grant or obtain government funding, right? The fact of the matter is many grants require you to match the grant and have skin in the game. Matching the grant, it's like MyTax. You want to hire an intern. MyTax will give you, your peer will give you $7,500 subsidy, but you have to match it with $7,500. And that's often what you see with government grants. It's in the matching base. You want 20,000, okay, put in 20,000. With the IRAP, it's also a matching fund. You want $100,000 from IRAP, well, you can expect that you will have to bring 100,000 in there as well. So it's always on a cost and risk sharing basis. That's very important. Myth number six, I don't need a business plan because I'm a lean startup. I have a lean canvas, you know? That's what the VC wants to see. Well, the thing is, government, you know, when government gives you money, it's public money, and there has to be a justification why the government gives you that money. So you need to articulate that in a business plan. It doesn't have to be an 80 pager, it can be a 10 or 15 page, but clearly articulate why do you need the money, how is it going to be used, and what are the return on investment of that public money. Even if it's a grant that you don't have to reimburse, you need to articulate what are going to be the economic benefits of your project. Government funding is there to create wealth for Canadians, and that's important to, you know, to articulate in your business plan. But mostly you'll need a business plan, at least with some cash flow projections, et cetera. The government wants to know how the public money is going to be spent. Number seven, oh, this is a good one. So you're checking the program website and you meet all the eligibility criteria, so therefore you are entitled to obtaining funding. And I indeed get sometimes yelled at because, you know, entrepreneurs call me, they have seen that, you know, they meet all the eligibility criteria and now they want the money. Unfortunately, it doesn't work that way. You are competing with many other companies to get those grants. Don't forget that. It's a very competitive process, even if you meet all the eligibility requirements. Many government programs are discretionary programs. That means it's up to the advisor at the program to determine whether you're gonna get the money or no, and you need to present very good business cases in order to obtain funding. Myth number eight, this is regarding the IRAP program. So IRAP funds typically R&D-based projects where there are technological challenges to overcome. So a lot of companies or entrepreneurs call me and say, hey, I have a high-tech project, now I'm entitled to IRAP funding, right? Well, even if you meet all the eligibility criteria, there's no guarantee you will receive IRAP money because IRAP looks at a lot more than just your technology. IRAP will look at, you know, do you have investors? Do you have a solid business case? what is the return on investment going to be if IRAP supports you with $100,000? How much employment are you going to create? You know, how are your exports going to increase, et cetera? And that is very important. So even if you meet all the eligibility criteria, it's not that easy to access IRAP funding. You know, there's over a million companies in Canada. Well over 100,000 meet all the eligibility criteria for the Industrial Research Assistance Program. Of those 100,000 companies, only 10,000 on a yearly basis are accompanied by industrial technology advisors at the NRC. And of those 10,000, 2,500 only receive funding on a yearly basis. So it's a very competitive process to get into IRAP, and you need to present a very good business case. Myth number 8, my company receives tax R&D credits from Revenue Canada and Revenue Quebec. Therefore, my company naturally should be entitled to IRAP funding, right? Well, the fact is, it's not because Revenue Canada agency says that, you know, you're doing R&D that you're entitled to IRAP funding, because they both use very different eligibility criteria. Keep that in mind. And vice versa. Myth number 10. My company receives IRAP funding, therefore my company should also be entitled to SR&ED tax credits, right? Because IRAP has done, you know, due diligence, so Revenue Canada should automatically approve my file as right, because, you know, you can stack government programs. So if you receive IRAP funding, you can also claim R&D tax credits. So you can stack some government programs. There are some rules to respect, of course. But it's not because you receive IRAP funding that Revenue Canada is going to rubber stamp your application. Be aware of that. So as an innovation advisor at the NRC, I typically accompany companies that are in the idea stage up to market and beyond. Although if it's just an entrepreneur who has just an idea, I will typically not spend much time with that entrepreneur. I will point him to resources that may be government resources that are going to help the entrepreneur with a business plan, maybe initial startup funding. I will guide the entrepreneur towards incubators. But once a company starts having R&D activities, I'll explain how SR&ED works. I'll refer probably the client to the IRAP program if I see this client would be a good fit for the IRAP program. I'll talk about Premier Brevet, which is a provincial program offering a $25,000 grant for a company filing a first patent. I'll talk about NSERC when I see that the company doesn't have the necessary expertise it needs in R&D in-house. And so I'll say, well, why don't you connect with the university? There's a professor there who can help you. There's a grant, an Engage grant, $25,000 that you can use. I refer quite a lot of my clients to MyTax, because it's a great program under MyTax acceleration. You know, a company can hire an intern at the master's or PhD level for a period of 4 months, and you also can leverage then the expertise of the professor and the lab for your R&D project. The Canada Media Fund, it's a fund that is sponsored to 1/3 of the financing from CMF comes from the federal government. So I will, if I see that a client, an entrepreneur has a project that's very interactive, developing an interactive platform with maybe a cultural dimension, I will tell them, explain them what is CMF, and I will guide them to CMF. Innovation Passport, of Passport Innovation, is the official title, is a provincial program. You can receive a $50,000 grant if you work, collaborate with public research institutions here in Quebec. The BCIP program that you see there between prototype and market, it's called the Built in Canada Innovation Program. This is a great program. Launched a few years ago by the federal government. If you are developing a technology or a product that could be used by the federal government, and you've developed a prototype or the final product, you haven't commercialized it yet, you're looking for your first client, the Built in Canada Innovation Program could actually purchase that invention and test it within federal departments. It's basically a purchasing contract up to $500,000. If you've developed a technology that can be used by the military, the contract can go up to $1 million. Here in blue, NRC Youth, YMCA, DSYP, the Digital Skills Youth Internship Program, the Prime Program, BioTalent, and ICTC Career Connect, those are wage subsidies. I don't know if you're aware, but this is actually wage subsidy. From April till probably end of summer or early summer, The government is distributing a lot of wage subsidies, and these are hugely popular, so people are flocking to them. So ICTC Career Connect, that's a wage subsidy. If you want to hire a recent graduate who's under 30 years old for an IT-specific job, BioTalent is a wage subsidy for the biopharma industry. Prime is a Emploi Québec wage subsidy if you are looking to hire an immigrant who has difficulty integrating the labor market, etc. So you see there's a whole bunch of programs, and this is just the tip of the iceberg. And as a company, it's not very easy to navigate through all these programs, and that's where I come in. Here, CanExport on the market. This is a new program that probably many of you don't know yet. This is a program if you're looking to develop a new market for a new product. The CanExport offers a 50% subsidy on eligible marketing expenses, and the subsidy ranges from $10,000 up to $99,000. There's an online application that you have to fill out. It's not too complicated. But as a startup, be aware that many of the programs, certainly for marketing, require you to have at least $200,000 or $250,000 in revenue. So if you have traction and you are attaining this level of between $200,000 and $300,000 in revenue, and you're looking for funding to market and export, go and knock on the door of CanExport or the QEDP, that's the Quebec Economic Development Program. That's also an interesting program. It's a loan program. 50% of expenses, marketing expenses, can be reimbursed in the form of a loan, but there's no personal guarantees, and there's also no interest to pay. So in my startup, I benefited from that program. BDC has market expansion programs, so has IQ. There's the Export Development Corporation that offers financial instruments if you're developing your market. MISIPEX, that's basically the Ministry of Economy, Science, and Innovation. So the provincial ministry has this PEX program, the Programme Exportation, which offers a 30% subsidy for all your marketing expenses up to $100,000. So there's a bunch of programs, and as I mentioned a few times, it's not always easy to navigate through all these sources. So you have fundica.com, you have concierge.innovation.gc.ca that can help you clarify which programs you would be eligible to. But if you need a personalized assistance, almost hand-holding, somebody who's going to explain you how to file an application, not really write them, but what are the criteria and how to file, etc., don't hesitate to call us. We have a 1-800 number. We're open all day across Canada. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks, Yo. Great service. So again, Yo, we've known each other for many years, you know, really has worked in the programs themselves and now can help you. And it is a free service, like some other things here. So really, and I'd say, you know, you're in terms of as an innovation advisor, you've got, you know, quite a bit of experience. So we're pretty fortunate to have you in the Montreal area. So thank you very much. So now we're on to the last pitch, and it is DOT, or DOT. Is that second to last? Oh, we got one extra one out, so we have two more. DOT, oh, that's right. We have, the last one is, well, we'll announce it after.
Hello, everyone. My name is Ishil Khan, and I'm the founder of DOT. While surveying parents and families with ADHD, which stands for Attention Deficiency Hyperactive Disorder, I met Jacqueline. Jacqueline is a mother of two. Jacqueline realized that her younger daughter, Michelle, was not like the average child from a very young age. She used to be embarrassed to take her into public, and she often felt frustrated. It was not until 4 years later that Jacqueline decided to take her to a hospital, and that too because a teacher recommended her to do so. It took another year for her daughter to be diagnosed with ADHD, but that wasn't the end of it. Jacqueline had to quit her job and move to a more developed city in order to get proper treatment. Michelle, on the other hand, had difficulty making friends at school. She felt isolated and lonely. She was picked on because she was different. Imagine not being able to connect to your very own mother. We surveyed over 200 such families, and what stood out the most was the number of years that were wasted before receiving any treatment. And even after receiving treatment, in the case of many others, which is usually drug therapy, it turned out to be ineffective. And there's no way to quantify this. I was born in Pakistan, and I grew up in Dubai, and I came to Canada for my higher education. I've taught children with special needs all around the world. ADHD, Tourette syndrome, schizophrenia, autism. At the end of the day, it's sad that the one-fit-for-all approach still prevails, and it just doesn't cut it anymore. Out of all mental disorders, ADHD is the most common. It affects 11% of all child population, accounting to 9 million children who are affected just in Canada and in the US. The annual cost per family is about $3,000, accounting to $27 billion being spent. My company, DOT, serves the purpose of diagnosis and therapy. We read brain signals to inform the parent when it's time to visit a doctor. DOT also provides games that use clinically proven techniques of neurofeedback to help the child develop the cognitive skills they need. So this is just to give you a snapshot of what our application looks like. The user has a private confidential profile. I'll talk about schools, doctors, and history in a bit, but if you click on the monitoring tab, the child is asked to engage in an activity for a minute or two, and the application spits out a result as to whether you need to go see a doctor or not. To process the incoming brainwaves, you use a third-party headset, and we use our algorithms to come to a final verdict. The thresholds we use for ADHD have been heavily tested in clinics and verified. We base our research off of Dr. Clark's, and we've taken into account the differences between a male and a female brain in order to offer a more personalized development. Today, we have our minimal viable product with the basic diagnostic in place, and we have 300 subscribers on our website. In August, we may aim to make our first release with one game suite focused on improving attention and the basic diagnostic. Prior to doing so, we will be partnering up with a data management company. This would be to facilitate remote health monitoring. RHM is the ability to monitor your patient outside the clinical setting of a clinic. And basically, the child's information would be available to the doctor, to the parent, as well as to the school. This would mean doctors can make decisions that would be data-driven now, and they can monitor the effectiveness of a drug. For parents, it means lowered costs because they can monitor the child from their home. For schools, this would mean that they have greater insight into child's learning ability. We will be selling directly to parents initially, and we'll start off with 50 users, and our growth rate would be 20% after that. By the end of the year, we will be distributing 60 free devices to healthcare professionals. This would be to show them the value in our product, as well as to gather more patient data. And that's when our leasing model kicks in. Our goal is simple. We aim to save the precious lives of every child. I myself am an electrical engineer. I work closely with Dr. Rashida, who is a PhD neuroscientist, Dr. Lama Sood, who is a PhD biomedical engineer. On our advisory board, we have Stefan Pellet, who is an angel investor, Sergio Escobar, who is the director of Founder Institute, as well as Dr. James Chisui, who is a PhD neurophysiologist, as well as an MD graduate from McGill University. Thank you. That's my pricing strategy, just in case you have questions about it.
Am I the first one? Okay.
Go first, yeah.
Okay. Sorry, I didn't see you. I'm just wondering, what's your margin of error, like misdiagnosing or, you know, making a mistake, and how would you correct that, and any legal kind of implications there? Sorry, overloaded question.
But. No worries. So clinically, the way it's done, let me rewind back to that a little bit, is 30 sensors are placed on the child's head, and the clinical sensitivity of the diagnostic is 95%. We've reduced that to 6 sensors that a person can use at home. Our sensitivity rate right now is at 85%. So initially, when we're going to consumers, we will not exactly be qualified as a medical device. We're going to be saying it's a device that helps children improve their attention. That's the strategy we will take before we enter clinical trials.
Yeah, can I dig deeper into that as well? Sure. I've seen a few companies offer different solutions based on research that try to tackle ADHD because it's a very big and prevalent problem. There's a fine line between being a consumer device and a medical device.
and diagnostic is something reserved for doctors. Between the language that you're using and the product that you actually have, how realistic is this business, considering all of the hurdles that you have not yet gone through, but that are limiting factors in being able to say, one, that this is a diagnostic tool, because that's what only doctors are allowed to do. Two, that the efficiency isn't at the level of the research that you're actually basing yourself on. And that to get this in the hands of people, it's extremely difficult because it's not a medical device and it has to be.
So starting off, initially for us, we're going to be there because we have talked to Ontario healthcare representatives. We will be qualifying as a class one or a class two device. And that puts us, what we would need to do is get a medical device licensing. The licensing itself would take a year or two to come through. And that is why our strategy is to go to consumers directly. I use the word diagnostic very loosely, and I probably shouldn't. That is going to kick in once we have our clinical trials in place, which is planned for next year.
Yeah, I would tell you don't use diagnostic at all.
Suggestion.
Because I'm a mentor at Hacking Health, at their accelerator, and I'm on the board of directors, and we've seen companies that say that they diagnose and they're diagnostic tools, and they're just not.
Right.
And so putting that out in the market is putting out a falsitude, mm-hmm. and it actually takes away any credibility from what you're doing.
Right.
You say you want to go directly to consumer first. What kind of advertisement would you do to in order to achieve that?
So as of now, we have about, as I said earlier, we have 300 subscribers already on our platform who follow up on us on a monthly basis, out of which 100 have actually agreed to use our device already. So our go-to-market strategy is essentially get feedback from them when they're using it and then publicize that and base it off their feedback as per se and use the data that comes in from their children to show that the child's attention span is actually improving. And that's where the management with the data management company would help out.
And you say you would promote that through which channels exactly?
So it's going to be direct sales to consumers. It's going to be a product. It's going to be a wholesome product with the headset and the application itself. And that's going to be sold at a cost of $400. So we're starting with 50 users. By the end of 2 years, we aim to sell 20,000 devices. And that would gain us a revenue of 1.4M. And later on, our leasing model and our subscription model kicks in.
I'm going to go back to Alex's question because I heard you say different things, and I'll have to admit I still don't quite grasp what it is you're pitching, because I heard the word diagnostic, which is one thing, another which was monitoring,
yes.
Which is another thing, another which you seem to be implying a measurement tool, continuous testing, which is supposed to do what? Give feedback in terms of whether my meds are working, whether other things are working. So just walk me through a little slowly what actually you're proposing here.
Sure. So the feedback that we received from parents initially was they knew from the very beginning that there was something wrong with their child. But as any parent would, they weren't likely to believe that their child actually has ADHD, right? So if you have the device, you can actually wear it and it'll give you a clear-cut diagnosis, and I shouldn't use that word freely. It would indicate whether you need to go see a doctor or not immediately. And then the reason why we still have that monitoring aspect in place is because usually children with ADHD are put on drugs, and the effectiveness of a drug might not be very effective. So the monitoring aspect comes in because if the child's on a drug, you can actually monitor and get clear-cut threshold based on their brainwave activity as to whether the drug is working or not. So that's where the monitoring and the diagnostic aspect are kind of interleaved.
Thank you.
All right, so this is the last presentation coming up here, Lesovich. Claim Compass. Alex here, take it away.
Timer's on there. All right. 5 minutes if you go over the questions.
Okay. Perfect. Thank you, Mike. Believe me, I'm looking forward for the drinks too, so. All right, hi everyone. So my name's Alex, and we're this close to the airport, so I decided it's a good idea to talk about the airlines a little bit and how to make them pay back for all the trouble, the lost luggage, the delays and all that. So how many of you here know that you can get up to $680 when your flight is delayed? US dollars, by the way. $680 US. One? Okay, it's pretty good. So how do I make this work? All right, so this is part of the problem. This is actually the problem. More than 90% of passengers are unaware that they're legally entitled to compensation when their flight is delayed, canceled, or overbooked. And those who know and try to get their money back run into trouble. Their claims are often denied, turned down, without sufficient grounds. So claiming compensation is hard, takes time, effort, and requires legal knowledge. I've personally gone through it, and it took me 4 months to get a rejection letter, even though I was entitled. So you may be thinking, is there a market there, since nobody here has heard about it? And I assume you're frequent travelers, most of you. There are 26 million eligible cases annually, of which currently only 3 to 4% claim compensation. With an average of $450 per claim, that's a $3 billion market. What we've done is we've built an automated claim filing and processing system. So what that means to you is, if your flight is delayed, all you have to do, go on the website, share your flight info. Our calculator instantly calculates the amount of money you're entitled to receive for free. You leave the work to us, and within a few weeks, we get back to you asking you how exactly you want to get your money. It's that simple. Now, the way we make money is very simple. We work on a no-win, no-fee basis, which means that we only make money when our clients make money. We keep a 25% commission, and that's an average of $120 per client. So there's clearly more winning than no fee with our success rate. It's 90% at this point, so. It's a very good market, very straightforward. We're not the only ones doing it. We do have some competitors. We have competitors in the UK, Germany, and Poland. But collectively, they hold no more than 10% of all claims. So no competitor implements full automation plus added value compensation in the form of partnerships, as we do. And moreover, our technology is built to scale. We can handle thousands of cases each week. Plus, we want to replicate our engine and apply it for things such as VAT refunds, smaller legal claims, other insurance claims, and even lost luggage. So the team, luckily nobody else is here. I'm the only one, so I can say whatever I want. But we have Tanya, who's our CEO. She co-founded two NGOs straight out of law school. Veli, who is a software engineer, previously worked for JP Morgan, and is now in DevOps. And you have myself. I've worked actually in the neighborhood for one of the major airlines for a couple of years. So yes, I'm definitely using that as my advantage today. With this team, we've achieved some great results. We've validated a business model. We've worked with over 400 clients. We have secured more than $100,000 in compensation from the world's leading airlines. We're currently fighting for more than $50,000 from the airlines. And what we're looking for is $700,000 to be spent over 18 months on developing our technology, APIs, which will be offered to our partners, as well as market expansion and hire marketing managers in order to have the first market mover advantage in the markets that we want to get in. As well as for the next 6 months, what we're going to be concentrating on is signing up more partners, smart customer acquisition, reducing our customer acquisition cost, and maximizing revenue by introducing a secondary revenue stream with our partnership program. Thank you. Yes, Alex.
Can I, I'm just curious, do you mind opening up the hood? So I'd like to understand, you know, we went through this whole presentation, seems really nice. I used to be a lawyer before, sadly, everybody has flaws. And I kind of want to understand, what is it exactly that you do? It cut off at the right moment. What exactly do you guys do in terms of like the internal process? You know, is it that you guys are sending demand letters? Are you guys threatening to sue them? Are you working with customer relations? Like, what is it that in your process allows you to continue to exist if they see that, okay, this is a prevalent problem, we're gonna just divert it and do it another way?
We do all of that, all of what you've mentioned. Yes, we do. We represent our clients. We state their case before the airline. Because as you've seen in the presentation, over 90% of passengers have no clue how to get their money back. And their claims get turned out without any sufficient grounds. So they turn to us, and we apply the law. So yes, we do bring airlines to court. We do work with letters as well. 90% of the time, we settle cases outside of the courtroom just because airlines know that they stand no chance. There's so many precedents of airlines trying to avoid liability on insufficient grounds. And what's unique about what we do is we only handle cases that have 100% chances of receiving their money. That's the whole purpose of the calculator. Otherwise, we're not going to take a case that doesn't stand a chance against the airline.
So if the case is very weak, you're the one who refuses it in the first place?
It just doesn't go through our system, yeah.
Okay. You have an algorithm to decide the case?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. You have one lawyer on staff. What is does that lawyer sign all the letters? What does the Bar Association of the various jurisdictions think of this?
We do have subcontractors as well. So, but at this point, as I said, it's rare that we would end up in court because we just managed to enforce the law without having to get to that point.
But I mean, I'm also a lawyer, but I don't have the bar. The Bar Act in front of me. But if you're doing the job of a lawyer, like sending a mise en demeure, is there a danger you're practicing law without a license?
No. Well, the letters that are sent to the airlines are obviously signed by lawyers. Yeah.
Okay.
I don't sign any of them.
So how do you do this at scale? Because you're working with lawyers, so some contractors. Like, how do you do that at scale? Say your company grows and the airlines are more and more aware of you know, companies like yours, trying to solve that problem for consumers. How do you do it?
How do we scale from here?
I mean, how do you settle so many of these delayed flights for consumers at scale? I mean, because right now you do it through your lawyers, and I guess you, like, how does it work?
Well, a lot of times, as I said, it's everything is automated. There's really no human interaction involved in the entire process. It's not like you have to go for each and say in every case you have to spend hours to go in court and then defend for $680. Yeah. That's not. But so a lot of that is just it's automated. So there's no.
Because that's what right now there's only a few people doing it. But what if it becomes a worldwide phenomenon? And so airlines start building more processes for this to be solved. How do you do this?
More legislation, you mean? Yeah. More barriers. Yeah. They're already trying to do that. This is. But once you establish a practice, there's really nothing. I mean, yes, in certain situations they try to. They ignore the claims and so forth, but they get fined. So according to, where the airline is based, there's regional legislation as well that applies. So, for example, a lot of places you can get, if you ignore a claim and you don't respond within 12 weeks, then you can get fined by national authority. So,
are you actually helping the airlines in a sense? And maybe this is an opportunity, but you can't be on both sides because the airlines will be able to treat the complaints that come into them more electronically, more automatically, and they save time also and resources.
We've thought about this, but the problem that they might have with us is that we're going to, instead of, for instance, at the moment, we might have a flight that's delayed with 300 passengers, and from this flight, only two would claim compensation. Otherwise, if we work with the airlines, then we're going to make them pay compensation for the entire plane. So I don't think they're going to be willing to cooperate with us.
So they'll save labor, but not money. Okay.
Thank you so much.
Pleasure. Thank you.
So up next, we will ask the panelists to actually complete their judging. And we'll proceed in a few minutes to live pitches by the Founder Institute Montreal chapter. So if I could get Dominic Bouchard from K-Suit, David Tran from HealthBond, Derek Moha from Walsh, Maha Benani from Match Glasses to the side here, please, to line up. That'd be great. We'll just get the panel members to complete their gradings. We'll compile the grades. And we'll get with the Founder Institute pitches. And the idea is for the whole audience to vote for their favorite Founder Institute pitch. They'll take the best prize will take home a cash prize. The best pitch will take home a cash prize. So we'll just give them a few more minutes. Thank you. Okay, perfect. So here's what's going to happen. So we have four pitches from the Founders Institute Montreal chapter. They're going to do 3-minute pitches each. And then we're going to get not the judges over here, but the audience is going to be the judge. You're going to take out your phone. You're going to vote for your, it's going to be like American Idol. You're going to text the message. You won't be charged. And then they're going to get $250 in cash prize. And then we'll announce the Fanica Roadshow Technopark winner. You ready? All right, let's give them a warm one. Just applause, thank you.
Hi, my name is Dominic. I'm a former litigation lawyer, and today I present to you Case and Suit. We're connecting clients and lawyers together directly online. So take an example. Here's a couple. They just bought a house, and they're now in a legal dispute with the previous owner regarding a hidden defect. Because of this, the house is now worth half the price they pay. Now they want a reclamation, and they're going to see a litigation lawyer. So they go to the law firm, but what they doesn't know is the lawyer is not specialized in hidden defect. Furthermore, he's giving expensive bill with hidden fees, and he is not transparent. On the other hand, they could have gone with an independent lawyer who specializes in hidden defect and is less expensive since there's no overhead. And also, he needs clients. So we thought, we're going to build a marketplace to help people with legal issues find and transact with an independent specialized litigation lawyer online. So the way it works is that we vet both the customer side and the lawyer side. We bring real clients to the lawyer and not just leads. And also, we connect clients with specialized independent lawyers. And we remain there as a third-party expert during the process. So the main feature is that we allow them to work together online, bringing full transparency and also save costs. We do that by allowing them to manage payments and transfer files directly online, reducing the back and forth with the lawyer, and also to keep everything in one place. The other thing is you get to know whenever your lawyer is working on your case or not, so you don't pay for hidden fees anymore and just for the job done. So comparing to the competition, we are an end-to-end marketplace, meaning that we touch every step of the process, we attract customers, we refer them, and we allow them to work completely online, both with the lawyer. So for the market size for the independent lawyers in America is a $25 billion market. But we start with the Quebec, and we're aiming at 300 lawyers independent in Quebec, which means, on average, it's a $50 million revenue market size. And we want to expand to the U.S. market, which is a $2.5 billion market for the independent lawyers in litigation. Our revenue model would be to charge a 50% transaction fee on every transaction on the platform, and keep in mind, every legal issue in litigation, on average, it costs $20,000 in legal fees alone. And it can go as high as $85,000 for a 5-day trial. So our go-to-market strategy will be to aim at just one legal event, which is buying or selling a house, because there's a lot of legal issues arising from that, like hidden defect, like contract issues or an insurance issue. And we're going to partner up with a real estate expert, like inspector or broker, to attract our first customer. And we're going to go also on Facebook to make campaigns on focusing homeowner only. The team is me and Olivier Druffaut. We are both lawyers. And we have a great team of mentors also. We have Sergio Escobar from the Founder Institute and Techstars. We have also Dominique Jean from KPMG, and we have also Zineb Quiri, who is a real estate expert. We actually looking to capitalize on the Canadian market, so we're asking for a 100K fund, and we want to thank you for your attention. Thank you.
All right. Hi, my name is David, and I'm the founder of HealthBond. At HealthBond, we want to help physiotherapists build long-lasting relationships with their customers. You see, for the past 2 years, I've been working as a physiotherapist, and there's actually no simple and smart way for me to keep track of my patient doing their exercise at home. The tools that are being used by most of the physiotherapists right now are handing out paper exercise, asking patients to keep a paper logbook, and whenever they have a question, they have to send me an email. Using these tools, we know that 7 patients out of 10 do not do their exercise entirely. And this increases up to 50% the chance of a patient dropping out of the treatment, which will result in loss in revenues for the clinic. So we decided to build HealthBond, a web and mobile platform to help physiotherapists keep track of their patient and stay connected with them in a smart and simple way. The patient will have access to a mobile platform so that they can view their exercise, log their activity, see their progress, and easily communicate with the clinician. On the other side, the clinician will have all the information in one single web portal to review easily. On top of that, the system The system can highlight all the patients who do not who require extra attention, so that the physiotherapist can focus more time on these patients in order to help them to keep their patient in the loop. So we offer a really simple pricing plan for clinic managers. Each physiotherapist will start with 5 free patients to try the platform, and for each patient that they add to their list, it will cost them $5. The physiotherapy market is $33 billion market in North America. And we want to start locally in Canada and aim to onboard 1,000 physiotherapists in the next 2 years for a $200 million market. And later on, we want to expand to the US to onboard 30,000 users for a potential market of $2 billion. So I have an amazing team working with me. My co-founder Alexander is a CRM and ERP consultant with a software engineering background, and I have Steven, a skillful software engineer working on my mobile app, and we work under the guidance of Sergio Escobar, the director of the Founder Institute Montreal and Techstar mentor, and Denis Pelletier, the president of the Ordre des Physiothérapeutes in Quebec, who is really excited to see innovation from Quebec. And we are excited to announce that we are in the talk with 2 clinics and a hospital to test our platform. And we are asking for $100,000 to help us build the product faster and push it to the West Canadian market. Thank you.
Hi guys, how are you? My name is Derek. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Walsh. At Walsh, we're building e-commerce marketing recipes. And I'm gonna explain to you in a few moments what I call about recipes. I've been running a small digital agency for 6 years. Actually, I created 2, one in Montreal and one in Europe. And I've learned one thing after spending hundreds of thousands of dollars of my money and my clients' money, is that conversions on most of the website between 2 and 3%, that's really low. So no matter how much you spend online in advertising, you convert poorly. So I was trying to find a way to convert more, especially on e-commerce sites, in order to make more sales when you spend advertising. And I found out that the best conversion weapon is the users that you have. So I tried to go further than that, and I was telling myself, how can I convert a visitor, not a user, someone who doesn't know anything about your brand, into an advocate? And I found out that the best and simple recipe is that every action that this visitor does result in a reaction. So currently what we do is when you do X on a product page, then Y happen, which is a reward. I'm going to explain it to you more clearly with an example. What we do currently is that we take your page and we allow you to sell something, and we allow user to make the price drop when they share or comment, and we also allow you to set the price to go up according to what happens on this page. For now, the recipes that we are testing with 15 people, most of them are fashion designers selling clothing and accessories, are based on the pricing go down and up according to users' actions. So like I just said, if you share and comment, the price go down. And if you can also set the price to go up after every purchase or after some time. So for them, the fashion designers and also the people who were testing our platform with trendy products, this is the fastest and easiest way to make a flash sale, but without hurting their brand, and by also promoting and making more, I would say, more customers. They also increase their sign-up email list. So what we want, what we were to go with this is we want to, in July, after the period of tests that we are currently doing, we want to enter the first e-commerce platform, which is Shopify, with our dashboard of recipes. We will improve and make more recipes, not only based on price, but on every action that you can do on a page. For example, if you exit the page, if you scroll down, if you wait, if you consult another page, etc. So it's like behavior marketing automation for e-commerce. And our competitors, I would say, are currently every tool that you can sell or promote your stuff is a competitor. So is it done? Thanks for your attention.
Hello, my name is Maha, and I'm here to present you Match Glasses. So our vision is to bring opticians and customers together into one single marketplace. When I was working at my mom's optical store, our clientele was either coming because they saw us on the street or because they were regulars. And we started losing clients to online eyewear shops. We didn't sell our glasses online, and like us, 76% of the opticians in the US don't have an online presence. Over the past 5 years, there has been an emergence of online eyewear shops, and we are missing out on a $3 billion market opportunity that is growing at 5% every year. On the other hand, we have Steve. He wants to shop for his glasses online, but doesn't have the time or the energy to wander the internet or the optical stores to find his glasses. So at Match Glasses, we bring together opticians and customers into one marketplace. And like a specialized Amazon, our opticians will be able to open their online store and start selling their glasses in less than 5 minutes. So for the optician, he will be able to liquidate his leftover inventory, open up to a whole new customer market, and know if another optician is putting the same frame at a lower price. When he receives an order, he will be able to ship the glasses to his customers. For our customers, when they come on our platform, they will be able to compare all the frames that the opticians sell, and will be able to use our personalized shopping experience where we profile them, analyze their face shape to suggest them the best frames for them. So the eyewear industry is worth $32 billion in North America and is growing at $50 billion by 2020. Our competitors are marketplaces such as Amazon and Etsy, where you can buy your glasses online. And we differentiate ourselves by specializing in the eyewear. We will be charging 25% commission for every glass sold, which will give us an average of $50 per frame. And so far, we have 8 optical stores between Montreal and Casablanca, where we will launch our first version. And we are going to New York, LA, and Toronto after that. So we are onboarding our optical stores by doing direct sales, exposing at trade shows, and doing partnerships with optical associations. And for our customers, we are using social media and doing partnerships with clothing lines. So for the team, I have a background in applied mathematics and business, and I grew up in the eyewear industry, so it runs in my blood. My co-founder is a specialist in digital marketing, and Mahir is a software developer. So our advisors are Sergio Escobar, who is the director of the Founder Institute and a mentor at TechStars, and Mehdi Meni, who is a growth hacker and CTO at M-Commerce. So we are raising $70,000 for our first release, and we are asking for $25,000 to close our angel round. And yeah, thank you.
All right. So we're gonna put up, thank you guys, great job. And if you guys wanna come out on stage. So guys, we're gonna ask all of the audience to become the voters and the judges for these guys. Text the number above, and each company has their own specific reference. So you just need to text the number above and include in the message their respective numbers. So for K-Suite, it's 7757. K-Suite, sorry. HealthBond, it's 7758. Walsh, it's 7759. And Match Glasses is 7762. And we're gonna, you guys can text for yourselves too. Beat the system, yeah. You can ask your friends and family at home also to text for you. No, you can ask your friends and family. Love money. All right, guys. HealthBond 7758, Walsh 7759, Match Glasses 7762, K-Suite 7757. All right, come on, guys, text, it's free. Okay. All right, so we're gonna do a countdown. 20, 19, 18, 17, 16, 15, 14, 13, 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, and the winner, Match Glasses! Congratulations. Let's take a picture with all of them. And congratulations again. You win $250. It's going to cover maybe a Ray-Ban. Free glasses for everyone, guys. And yeah, thank you. Can we have a picture of her alone? Thank you, guys. Sorry. Rich, can we play some soft music in the background while I announce the winner? Can you? Oh, and guys, Mike just reminded me, this has all been live streamed. I'll come up. This has all been live streamed on YouTube. If you go on fandikaroadshow.com, YouTube, all of the different events across Canada have been live streamed and archived, so you can watch them anytime. And so you can revert back to any of the road talks today. And we'll also be posting all of the presentations, if our speakers allowed it, on SlideShare. So we'll send you to all of the attendees through Eventbrite, check your email, the link for the YouTube, and as well the SlideShare link. That's good? Cool stuff. All right, so. This trophy has seen better days. Mike.
Oh, thank you. All right, yeah, I like this.
stuff. So we had 9 pitches today that presented in front of a panel of, what are you doing? The music is a bit, yeah, it's kind of weird. I'm feeling uncomfortable right now. Okay, no music. Okay, so we still have 2 more stops. Thank you guys so much for attending the event. Thank you to my team, Katie, Shona, Vanessa, Dana back home, Mike in here, Debbie, Lucky Charm, and many more people that you guys don't get to meet during the event. We have a fantastic team that actually makes it happen. We have a fantastic group of partners, community partners, national partners, sponsors, hosting partners. Thank you so much for Technopark for always, you know, welcoming us and making it so nice today, you know, despite the fact that it rained. And thank you to our judges as well for coming out and our speakers. It couldn't be done without you guys. So we had a fierce competition. And
One big special thanks. So the person who's run the show from beginning till now, really, really behind it, Lana. Thank you, Lana.
Thanks, Mike. So amazing team, like you guys saw. And so we had a really good competition today. Thank you guys for supporting us. And without further ado, so the winner for the Montreal Technopark 2016 Fandika Roadshow is, drumroll, Faison. Congratulations. Congratulations. I get a picture with the winner, by the way. So you win round trip airfare to San Francisco for those who weren't there, a pitch to VCs and angels in the Valley. We've heard recently that one of our winners last year actually just got, you know, a deal with San Francisco investors. That's what we... Once they close, we'll announce it, guys. But things are looking good for them. 3 months office space in the Valley and 1 free year of QuickBooks Online, you know, mega cloud hosting package from Canary and IBM, as well as free tax credit, R&D tax credit assessment from R&D partners. So congratulations, Chris. And if you would like to say a few words, what are you going to do in San Fran?
Yeah, I will be paying the rent. That's only what I'm going to do. So thanks a lot. I really appreciate. I think maybe a tips for guys, it's really when you're getting traction that you can actually, well, most of the time raise funds. So really, guys, focus on attraction and maybe less on getting funds really now, because, you know, it takes a lot of time and your focus switched to another thing. So please, guys, consider this. Make sure you validate the market, then move on. So yeah, thanks a lot for that. We're ripe for investment, I think, and we'll make Montreal proud. Thanks a lot.
So thanks a lot again, and thank you all for coming out. Lastly, thank you to Richard and Cynthia for making all this happen. Thank you so much. He does a fantastic job if you watch our videos. And drinks are served inside, guys. Enjoy. Thank you all.